Welcome to 155, a podcast about punk songs, and until recently, a podcast about the Offspring. Now, this is the final episode of the Offspring November, which was preceded by the Offspringtober, I think it was called.
I think so.
It's been two full months of Offspring coverage. It's not only the final episode of those 2 months, it's actually the final episode of 155 podcast of the year 2022. We have decided we're going to strictly focus on what we do best, which is peddling the Patreon for the month of December. I was going to pretend that it's like a much needed break, but I already know what we've got planned. It's not really much of a break, except we're just going
to... I feel like it was sold to me like it was a break, and then I increasingly realized that it's not.
Oh, yeah, there's no breaks, and also...
There's no relief.
There's no relief, and I mean, that's going to be the vibe today as well as we enter the final episode of The Offspring in November. There's no time, really, to do...
You were being so solemn. You're being, like, very, very solemn in this introduction, which makes me very... uncomfortable. It's disconcerting. Your tone is putting me on
edge.
Well,
yeah, that's good. I mean, edging, that could be a thing. That could be the name of a song.
Give that to a band.
There's a few things going through my head today as we prepare for our final episode of 155. Well, that would be podcast. First. Oh my god. Look at him go. God damn.
That's right. I'm feeling shook today.
Here's the thing. All right. Obviously, you know, we are a GQ approved podcast. Gentlemen's Quarterly has decided that we exist as a podcast. So fuck the AV Club and any other sort of abbreviation based.
We've been waiting for news these like homely websites to acknowledge our existence when truly, because we are gentlemen, it was going to be the quarterly, our quarterly all along to finally sort of shine, exactly. Shine God's eye on us.
Now, you might have heard tell, and this one is an organic one, but there is a Patreon episode of Blink 155 where we go into depth about the Travis Barker feature that mentions the pod. But one of the main takeaways is that we were called, I already forget what we were called.
Admirably exhaustive.
Admirably exhaustive as a podcast. And I was really, you know... Something that it's just one of those things, like, obviously so many stupid, funny things happen to me all the time because I'm just a big old goofball. And so there's always someone's yelling at me or screenshotting. To me, they all kind of blend together. Someone saying they want to kill me because of Starbies is kind of the same as being featured in Gentleman's Quarterly. It's all just some funny thing.
I believe that for you. Narrative thread. Yeah, it's all part of the continuum. It's just all part of the Josiah's beautiful life.
Exactly. But this one keeps coming up. The GQ thing keeps coming up. And so I keep... being reminded that that we were called admirably exhaustive. So that's on one hand. On the other hand, I keep thinking, are we, though? You know, like people say, you're admirably exhaustive. Well, are we, like, I feel like we've been talking about the Offspring for 2 months straight, and I do not feel like I've really...
We don't know their names.
...cracked the code.
We don't know what dates.
We don't know their names. I don't have the vibe.
To be fair, I think they were referring perhaps to the Blink-specific era of the pod.
So you're just going to dismantle my setup for the whole episode is what you're going to do. Okay.
Well, I thought you were asking. Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Go.
You're right.
I was bringing it into the sales pitch, which I thought was true. You normally feel like I leave you high and dry on the hard sell.
You're right.
So
okay.
I was addressing an earlier criticism of me. And in doing so,
to keep track,
stepped on it, just can't do anything
all
right.
All of the jabs, all of the passive aggressive jabs being
the new passive aggressive.
No, you're right though. You're right. They were talking about Blink 155. So that's the thing. Are we admirably exhaustive anymore? I would argue we're not. We just dip in and out of some aging punk rockers' lives, and then we move on to the next shiny thing that we find, whether it be.
It's like it means nothing to us.
Yeah, you know? And so. I was thinking as we end the year early before we go behind the paywall for the month of December, as we sort of say goodbye to what has been, I think, a great – I think talking about Gentleman's Quarterly, I think Q4 2022 fuggest into Offspring. I don't know what I'm – everything about it doesn't give me a stroke, but in a good way, I think. I feel like I'm having a stroke talking about the pod. We've been nailing it, but I don't think we've been admirably exhaustive, so – Sam knows this, kind of. I don't think you fully know what you're getting into tonight, but...
No, apparently I don't, because I was like, oh, we've got the amount of time that we have, and then
we don't have that amount of time. There might be multiple sessions. So this episode title is Let the Bad Times Roll, but we're not going to do the song Let the Bad Times... We're going to do...
Well, we are.
We're going to do mini episodes about every song from the album Let the Bad Times Roll by The Offspring. So we're going to go through each track by track and do a mini episode for each song and see, try to become.
Thanks, GQ. Thanks.
Really exhaustive with it. Let's get started, really. I think we could skip the punk news segment this time, which is actually usually 20 minutes, by the way, when I edit the show. Yeah. Like, this is 20 minutes, but let's start. So we did, you know, one thing you did know we were going to do is we did do the, what you perfectly coined the bad times challenge, and it has a hashtag. And so encourage the listeners right now, I think you should take the bad times challenge, which is just, you have to listen to the entire album. It's disgusting.
Yeah,
it looks like I actually set my Spotify to private session to listen to it.
I was worried that Apple doesn't have the same sort of social features, but I was like, is this going to change? Like, meaning, because obviously we've talked about like our algorithms on other platforms being garbage, but in general, like, I don't deliberately expose myself to music that I don't like.
Right.
Because like when I'm listening to music streaming, it's like on my, you know, that's my time, right? Yeah. That's not jokes time. And in my head, I was like, people are going to see, like, if someone else navigates over to that record, they will see, because you do get, like, oh
they'll see that
listen to it, and they'll see, like, I'm clocking hours, and who knows, like, I do so much playlist stuff now that I'm worried about listening to that many Offspring songs in a row, like, they're going to show up, they're going to be my top 10 most listened to artists.
See, that already makes me feel better about that we've done our job here, I would encourage everyone to take the Bad Times Challenge with us. I think... As we go,
we basically never tell people to listen to the song for the episode, but I think, yeah, this is one where pause the podcast
each time.
Open up your
I think that's true. Pause it, pull over.
I want to make, maybe you and I disagree about what the Bad Times Challenge is. I think part of the challenge is that you are listening to the entirety of Let the Bad Times Roll, the deluxe edition that ends with the live track. Because I think if you're stopping, it's not the same. It's like if you were trying to chug milk, you know, if you were just to drink just a liter of milk over the course of a day, like, who cares? I want you to be chugging that liter in a very short period of time.
And let's see.
So you got to slam that Let the Bad Times Roll like a bag of milk.
That's true. We didn't clarify whether or not it was the deluxe edition, but I'm happy to hear that you listened to the full deluxe edition.
Yeah, I'm committed. I'd look at a Bad Times Challenge. I'm the originator.
Okay, so everyone pause. Spend 40 minutes and 48 seconds listening to the newest Offspring album, and we'll give you a second. Just right here, we'll mark the time. Okay, so you're back. You've listened. How are you feeling, listener?
Hey, how's everybody
what
doing?
Do we want to say how we feel about it before we get into the track by track, or should we just start? What do you think?
The only thing I'll say is that I felt like I really had to do it. And there were times where I was like, okay, I've got the gist of this song and I wanted to skip it. And I knew that I had to commit to the challenge. And similarly, there were times where I wandered.
Yeah.
Like, I really wandered mentally. I was like doing some emails, and then I'd realize like I was halfway through another song and I'd be like, oh, I don't think this counts anymore. And so I went back and like started it in the middle.
Yes.
So like
you did it. You did the challenge.
Focused on this album. And it was like a really unpleasant, like a thoroughly unpleasant experience. How about you?
I had a kind of similar thing. Now, I did, because we're doing a mini episode about each song tonight, I was taking notes while, so it was almost an even more hyper-focused listening, because I was listening for lyrics that jumped out at me. I was, you know, seeing what else was out there. Actually, I took notes YouTube-wise before I listened to the album, so I already had a bit of a flavor for each song based on what kind of things I found. What I was most taken back by, though, I think, is that it really is an Offspring album. Like, it really does feel like what I remember Americana felt like and why I stopped liking this band. Like, there is some sort of true Offspring feeling to this disgusting piece of shit album, in my opinion.
Yeah, I don't know that I agree. Only because I feel like, at least with Americana, the last Offspring album that I owned and truly listened to in its entirety, there's more of like some sense of cohesion. Like, even though you have those big novelty tracks in it, like this one from the very beginning, I don't understand like what type of music it's trying to be.
It definitely starts bad. So, okay, let's get into
it. The bad times roll essentially immediately.
This is not Utopia. It seems like I wrote down goofy ass drums, and I also wrote down AI vocals. Like, the vocals to me do sound AI.
Oh, crazy.
And the song title too also kind of seems AI, in my opinion, doesn't it? Like, it's kind of just like an AI version of I know calling things AI is pretty played out at this point, but it's just like, there's no other way to describe this. Feels like Dexter might be dead and his frozen head in a Futurama lab is being forced to make new music.
There's something thoroughly like uncanny about it in that specific generative sense. My note is not dissimilar. It is, what on earth is this supposed to sound like? How do you even write a song like this? It's like if you had a dream about a 90s Bad Religion song that like wasn't a Bad Religion song, you know? That's how I interpreted it. Where the chorus is like recognizable, but it's kind of like one of those things where you're like, I had a dream about Josiah, but it wasn't Josiah, but I knew it, but it was Josiah.
Yeah, totally.
For me, it wasn't Josiah. Like, that's the vibe where you're like, it's recognizable somewhere like deep in the bowels of my brain, because in my brain shits. So right. It has a whole system.
Of course.
I mean, it does.
Well, no, like something about the way that it sounds there was a few things getting delivered today. So I couldn't wear my headphones because I had to listen for the buzzer. As soon as it was delivered, that's when I stopped researching the pods, this week's pods. And I put my headphones on and I started the album at a loud volume. And as soon as it started, I thought, is there like a tone dial on my speakers that I plug into that I've accidentally nudged? Like, it sounds like there's like a mid boost or something. Like, it's just like, it sounds fake.
I'm spoiling one of my notes, because about halfway through the album, maybe four tracks in, I stopped listening in the middle of the song and put on something else, because I was like, are my headphones fucked? Like, because it just doesn't sound like music. Like, it doesn't sound like what you would identify as like any kind of rock or popular music produced in the last 30 years.
Yeah.
And so I went and I like checked it with other music, like also streaming music on the same platform. And I was like, okay, so it's not that. And then it went back and I was like, what is the set? And that starts from the very beginning with Dexter's vocals. And it feels like there's a few songs. And I do think this album was recorded over like a prolonged period of time. Like,
yeah,
the first quote unquote single came out 6 years ago. And so I think there's like a little bit of a Chinese democracy thing happening where it was probably just recorded in a many, many different places and in many different settings. But
it seems like you're saying racist when you reference that without mentioning that you're talking about an album title for some reason.
Right. You're right. That's good. Just giving me the vibe of this idea that I've thought of. Just something a little unreal about it.
So, I mean, I have a live video of this. I have a couple things. I have a couple little nugs for each track. But I wanted to start with on r/theoffspring. So someone says, well, actually, lesbian.
You have a job. You have a job. You have a job.
Some of this I did during a meeting today. I'm not going to lie.
I know.
This was posted by
We decided to do this morning. Like, the way that we decided to do this happened this morning.
Lesbian-bitch- 2 years ago on R the Offspring said, anyone have an idea on what This Is Not Utopia is about? Is the header. And then it says, I mean, I assume BLM, but IDK. So it's just very dismissive and fucked up. And then people just kind of, you know, mention the roots of America, the roots of America. Like, the lyrics are pretty funny. But then from a Forbes interview with Dexter, heads up, viewing that site on mobile is a nightmare, says from Lurker 2 poster. The first song, This Is Not Utopia, talks about the roots of American hysteria. Is this a song that perhaps hints that the ego of American exceptionalism has been a bit unwarranted? That's quite a heady question. Well,
Forbes is really
Forbes is Forbes.
No, this is my interpretation of it. Like, the roots.
And then Dexter says, for sure, look around. It's obvious that this is not utopia. To put it in a nicer way, we could do better. We could do better, right? It's important for us to not come across as political. I never want to be preachy. I never want to tell you that you should think like this, that you should do something or act a certain way, but I do want to throw the observations out there and you can draw your own point, whether you are a liberal or a conservative, to think about the things that we can all do to make things better. So that's kind of interesting.
I feel like in every interview that the Offspring do, they talk about how they're not political, and like no one's asked, no one's like, so would you consider yourself, like they offer up that information so readily, and it feels the same as when someone opens up any sort of political question by saying, now listen, I'm not conservative, right. Or like I don't vote Republican.
I don't even pay attention to the news.
Like, yeah, that's what it is. That's actually what it is. Yes. Well, I don't really pay attention to politics, but it seems to me like
it's kind of like some drain the swamp shit. Honestly, it's kind of the vibe I'm getting. So
we don't want to seem political, but it just seems to me like there are a lot of people living off welfare, a lot of bees, if you will.
So unfortunately, as we go through these songs, you know, I've wrote down a couple phrases that popped out, but. Other than that one Reddit thread where it says it might be BLM by IDK, there's not a whole lot. The song meanings community is dead, straight up. So this album came out 2021 song, but...
Heartbreaking.
We don't have to click this one, but we are, for almost every single song, there's a new website called Song Meanings and Facts, and their author, Amanda London, has written a sort of a grade 9 style essay on each track. I mean, I feel like it's mostly SEO bait, but... it's incredible. I mean, even just one blurb from this one says, it may sound as if it were written in reference to the racially based riots that swept across America during 2020. However, okay. Dexter had actually written it before the killing of George Floyd and what have you.
And what?
So it's going to be a long night, my friend.
It's like the things of that nature. Yeah. David Roth tweet.
Exactly. So we'll check in on song meanings and facts in a second. But first, here's the Offspring performing this live at Prism Kingston. I don't know if this is Kingston, Ontario. PRYZM. It's acoustic version.
Oh, wow.
Should we give it a shot? You guys want to hear this song?
I really... Whenever Noodles is given the mic, I'm always like, cut that guy's mic off.
Let's try it.
Seems like he's going to say some bad uncle stuff at a wedding.
Imagine going to see the Offspring play acoustic. And they're going to play a new song, acoustic.
I mean, it sounds like dog shit. The drumming's horrible. I don't know. They got to bring back the anti-vax guy if it sounds like this.
I feel like they're missing him. Or did he play on the record? I feel like we probably
Through this. Who cares? Maybe the problem is just who cares. So here's Dave Thomas Music covering this one acoustically. This is a ripped ponytail.
Like a shot without a warning.
I don't know what this guy looks like. It's like...
Oh, it's saw. Pete Parada did play drums on this, except for tracks 2. So Let the Bad Times Roll and We Never Have Sex Anymore.
Oh, so just not on the singles. This does have like sort of sexy, sensy vibes, except this guy is like a ripped beard ponytail. He looks like Black Rifle Coffee as a man.
Also, did he just say like Raleigh Hollies? Is he just do they make Irish people this big?
Apparently.
Life is cheaper.
Well, okay, a couple more. This is the Night Owls. This is a family band covering this one. The drums are so interesting. It's like jazz band. Also, the singer girl was doing like low-key TikTok dances before she started singing. And then dad playing guitar.
This is great. This is nice.
Yeah, it's kind of cute. And then finally, this is a band that does a lot of covers. This is them doing... This is not video. Utopia. I don't know if it's... Is it loading for you?
Is there a part of me... Yeah, it's loading.
Oh, no. I got the wrong intro. This is someone else. I don't know who this is. But it's great. What are you saying?
I don't think that, like, melodically the song is bad. It's just... And this is Bob Rock, right? Like, it's like... Yeah. It's just produced in a way that is baffling to human ears.
Okay, so final thoughts on This Is Not Utopia.
Well, it's certainly not Utopia for me. But for people who like podcasts, they should check out Utopia to Me, which was a great Chris Locke podcast. What about you?
It's insane. We're going to die tonight, finally. You know, I always say to you, and I intentionally didn't say to you while I was doing this earlier, that it was going to be a struggle to get through, because I knew that would just kind of get your, I don't know. Like, when you were thinking about the Let the Bad Times Roll episode, were you thinking it was going to just be an easy night?
Yeah, I was.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It was.
And it is going to be easy in the sense that we're going to lose ourselves. Any kind of hanging on to control is going to be let go of immediately.
Great.
This
is such a great thing that we do.
Let the Bad Times Roll. I mean, the title track from the album, I wrote down, it really is a bad time, first of all, obviously. I think it's kind of like a rallying cry kind of song. Like, it reminds me of like some of the songs from the Nickelback Machine era from like, you know, 7 years ago or something. Like, kind of like when music videos had like vague.
We haven't talked about the new Nickelback yet.
I haven't heard it actually, but
it's pretty groovy.
I feel like they've made a mistake with the branding. Like, I feel like they shouldn't do Calgary van culture.
It's real Shore Store energy. It's very strange.
Yeah.
So Machine Era Nickelback, though.
Yeah, it has like kind of that kind of like rallying cry. And then I noticed that he said, just a few lyrics stood out to me. He says bitch again, of course, but this time he's talking about Hillary Clinton, I think. Which I think, you know, again, for an album coming out in 2021, I feel like it's too late to be talking about Hillary Clinton. And I thought he was saying pucker up, but he was saying lock her up. I think this is a song about Trump, but I also love...
Yeah, it's Trump POV.
Couple more lyrics. Hey, Lincoln, how does your grave roll? So I guess they're trying to say that Lincoln's rolling in his grave, maybe, because of Trump. But they've accidentally... sort of described a scenario where Lincoln's grave itself is rolling, which is kind of interesting. It almost seems
neat.
Like if the country was going so well, the grave would be rolling rather than the person inside. It's almost the opposite kind of thing.
That's interesting.
And then I just wrote this down because I thought it would be interesting to sort of to take it out of context of the song. Hey, oh baby, let the bad times roll. On a stripper pole, oh, 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 yeah, fuck it, let the bad times roll, oh, 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 fuck it, Mexicans and blacks and Jews got it all figured out for you.
Yeah.
It's kind of an interesting song here.
Well, I think that's the part where he's kind of like doing like SoundCloud rapper flow. So I wrote, my note for this is, what the fuck? Did they record all Brian's vocals on his phone while he was driving? He is spitting, though. Wow, the B word again. Obsessed much? Oh, wait, he's with her. This man is reaping what he has sown. Because it feels like this is sort of continues as the album rolls on, but it's like almost the band sort of coming to this what looks like a sort of more leftward position than their previous one, but it's really just like... kind of like a hashtag resistance POV. Yeah. But there's a point where that blacks and Jews line, he's like, like, it's really, he's kind of,
I just want to know what,
rapping a little.
Who told Bob Rock that this would be a hit? And also the other fucked up thing is I think it is a hit. I think most of these songs are massive hits. Like,
these aren't hits.
I mean, how do you define a hit, I guess, is the question. But
a song I want to listen to.
Right. You can see the numbers on Spotify and like these songs.
Oh, for individuals. So how do these compare to these? Because Apple doesn't have like that feature, I guess.
They're not in their talk, but like Let the Bad Times Roll has, if we're rounding up, 36 million plays on Spotify.
Wow.
Isn't that I'm gonna look at these on. That's kind of insane. That's
so
fun.
You know what? Like, what do we know? Like, I get that we're like not.
It's amazing.
What? I that's actually.
So while you're looking at that, I think it's worth just real quick taking a brief look at Amanda London's writing on songmeaningsandfacts.com. Specifically, let's start. So Let the Bad Times Roll is actually a mocking of Let the Good Times Roll, the name of a musical piece dating back to 1946, which truthfully I did think, you know, it's funny that there's a lot of revisiting the well in this, and the kids aren't all right was obviously one time that they've switched it on us, and that to say like, let the good times roll. How about let the bad times roll? So Amanda Lennon says this is the name of a musical piece dating back to 1946. Said tune is a classic, and even more importantly, in relation to the matter at hand, let the good times roll is a phrase widely used in American society, which points to the concept of having fun, i.e. partying. Well, based on their explanation of the song we're researching today, the Offspring definitely feels that time have changed quite a bit since the 1950s era. To them, this is manifest not only in the pessimism of our leadership, but also a general feeling amongst the masses that it's all going to hell. And this band is not alone in recognizing such a mass sentiment. Verily, within the past year, we have researched a number of songs which are premised on a feeling of widespread gloom, as the troubling 2020 would have it. But even beyond that, we can also say that this is the Offspring's own reaction to the idea of the world progressively degenerating, a concept that has also been covered by musicians well prior to 2020. I mean, I don't think, have you ever watched In Fabric based on my multi-time wreck? There's one character.
Now it's not on Crave anymore.
There's one character in Fabric who talks exactly like how this is written. I don't know if anyone will know that, but I mean, I love that interpretation of it. That verily, it's about how things are actually bad, not good.
Wow! Like this doesn't seem like something that was written. Like by a bot, because I was like, maybe this is
that's
just
the thing.
Like
I know
filling,
there's just enough human
like a human being has overwritten this. Yeah,
it's incredible. Okay, so let's just check out a live video of them playing it on 98 Rock Baltimore, fake VHS effect at the start.
All right,
this song is insanely bad. Also, who's playing the acoustic in here? This is not even a live video.
I feel like there's just like a lot of stuff. Maybe he's playing it through. He's got one of those pedals. There is so much on this record, I think, of like classic Offspring sounds being used. Like that's definitely at the start is the sound of Come Out and Play.
But then this part turns into this sounds like Nickelback kind of. It's like hockey rock.
Yeah.
It also seems like it could be like of late era hot heat like side project with Hoxley Workman or something. Like it does sound a little bit like Grant Rock, and also the octave chords right there are really sick.
Yeah.
So,
but this that like why is that what happened?
Yeah, what is that part? Oh, actually, you know what? I didn't write it down, but he explains why it happens.
Because they wanted this. Spin.
If you're, it's gonna come up later again. But if you're doing some kind of like ironic character, have we not learned from the past like 30 years that your listeners are too stupid? And if you're just rapping like Mexicans and Blacks and Jews, like that's not gonna, they're gonna take that out of context. It's not gonna work. But he did say in actually an Apple Music annotation session, he said the chorus. The verses are rocking, they're pretty heavy, and then it goes to this light chorus, almost like a musical coping mechanism. Because the song is about how everyone's just like being like, fuck it. You know, it's kind of about like nihilism because everything's turned to shit.
Damn.
One of the worst songs ever made. Let's check out this guy, Sebastian Legoff, do a quick cover. A lot of people just pretending to play acoustic guitar on electric guitars with this song. But this guy's in such an erotic room. I don't know how else to describe this room. It looks like the Tommy Wiseau sex scene room.
It's pretty cool. That's what the room I'm in looks like right now.
Yeah.
Honestly, they've got a way with the melodies. That when I just like really squint.
I know there's something there. That's the worst part. Is that there's something? Here's a metal cover of it by Cyanosphere.
I mean, but you're right. Like if this was like a if Nickelback had this song, this would be like a top 10 Nickelback song.
Yeah, it'd be a sick Nickelback song.
Like one of those like heavy ones. Like, ooh, Nickelback do rock though.
I bet you Dexter has Chad's email. You could just send it to him. Like, yo, I have a sick song for you.
This is so bad.
And then finally, there's just this guy. I think we've seen him before. Yeah, this guy's really intense. Some really intense rocker.
Look at him go!
Oh, wow. I think one of my favorite things is the cutaway where you can see he's got the shelf, he's got the guitars up on the wall, he's got the cool light, he's got whatever. Yeah. And then he also just has, like, all of the various Ernie Ball strings, like he's a guitar
like
store.
On display? Like, that's not an impressive thing to own. I think this guy who has, like, a very stringy, stripey snake bite beard and like belts it out from a side profile for some reason, that's who the Offspring is for. Like, we need to understand this guy to understand the Offspring, and I don't know if we ever can.
That's true. We cannot, like, we are limited. We're I think one of our talents with this, you know, endeavor, you know, I think is you and I are like decently empathetic, right? Like, we're not smart, right. But we do our best, and this is one of those things where, like, I think we've reached the limits of empathy. Not that I can't, we will never know this man.
We'll never understand it, but we'll be damned if we stop now. So what's your final thoughts on What's the Bad Times Roll, the song?
Well, like, to be honest, so far, I'm kind of liking this Let the Bad Times Roll experience. And so I just want to sort of have that as, like, a marker so that we know in a few hours, like, how right. how much I hate this whole idea. But, like, as of right now, I'm like, all right, this kind of works for me.
Okay. I kind of agree. Like, I guess I just think it's really impressive that a band like The Offspring could write a song this bad that still works in its own close. It's like Avatar, basically. It's like, obviously it's terrible and aesthetically bad, but something about it works so well that it resonates with so many people. And that's kind of like what I think that song is, in a way. It's Avatar.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, maybe this is just going to make us, like, truly, like, maybe now we're going to finally, like, really understand all
maybe we will.
At the end of this record.
Okay, the next song is Behind Your Walls, which I don't really remember, but I thought there's really funny background vocals. I think he says walls of pain, and then the anger drives you insane was a lyric that stood out to me as just being like just like really free punk lyrics. And I think this song was too rockin' for me, though. I didn't really take too in-depth of notes. What about you?
This one I wrote, there wasn't a ton here. I wrote just at the very beginning, Behind Your Walls, I wrote sex metaphor. This entire song went by before I could think anything else about it. Had to rewind, which has made me genuinely annoyed. Trying to do Gone Away Again, fuck off with this. Like, it feels like very middle, where they're going to say something meaningful or whatever.
Yeah.
But this is where I, like, just sort of, like, my brain went away.
It's very quickly, yeah. Well, let's hear what Amanda London from songmeaningsandfacts.com has to say about Behind Your Walls by The Offspring. The Offspring's Behind Your Walls is a song about depression, and the person who is suffering from this affliction would be the addressee. Moreover, he or she is someone whom the vocalist cares about. So the addressee's current state has the narrator concerned. But this is not simply due to this person feeling down. Rather, he is suffering from that kind of despondency, whereas he has basically closed off the rest of the world, living behind walls of pain, as the singer puts it. And as a backdrop, said vocalist, the Offspring's Dexter Holland has witnessed his fair share of suicides of what have you. So yes, he is very much concerned for the current state of the addressee. He knows that depression is real and can bear devastating fruit. So even though to the uninitiated, the addressee may simply come off as being docile or disinterested, Holland is able to ascertain that something more serious is going on. So that kind of clears
it up
a little
bit. When you found this, was this when you knew, like, okay, this is an important episode? Like, did this blog, like, really open it up for you?
Yeah. Like, my first thought was, like, okay, I'll just, you know, we were going to get live videos, and then I was like, maybe I'll just see if there's a cover of each song, just one. And then I kind of lost. I had a little bit of free time today, or I was procrastinating something. And
but
then I really.
Amanda London
has really. Yeah. Song Meanings and Facts. So everyone check out songmeaningsandfacts.com. I also love, like, the hero or the menu at the top of the website is home. The things you can click on: home, Billie Eilish, Eminem, BTS, top 100 songs of the 21st century, today's top hit songs, contact us about. I couldn't find anything about Amanda London, but she's easily my favorite journalist, rock critic of the day.
Yeah. her most recent post is about Flashdance, What a Feeling, of course, RIP Irene Cara. And I just real quick, some listeners have taken Flashdance, What a Feeling, as a song of general inspiration, i.e. the type of self-encouragement tunes we have become accustomed to in the 21st century. And whereas, based on Irene Cara's own interpretation of the lyrics, that theory may hold true. Understanding the song solely as such sort of oversimplifies what's going on here. Sort of is very weird in there. this is to say that this is not simply the case of dancing being synonymous with ambition in general, since the song was created specifically for a dance-related movie. But at the same time, Irene herself was a professional dancer, and she did take this piece as being a metaphor about a dancer, though under her estimation being more about exerting control over life as such an individual would over their own body during dancing. Amanda London, my favorite music journalist.
Absolutely. Okay, here's
no question.
Here's the Offspring doing a 91X session performing Behind Your Walls.
91X.
All right, I'm ready if you guys are.
It's acoustic also.
Inside in the in the radio studio with the sunglasses on.
Ready when you guys are.
Tell me, how do I reach you when all I see is a stare?
He's got yes. Like, how is he real?
How do you look for the signs when nothing is there?
He does seem like so he's just a composite of every cover section flame, uncle that we've ever seen.
Yeah.
Insane.
Yeah, I think that's it. It's like,
look from behind your walls of pain.
Even like the bands, like the sort of big punk bands that you tell and I don't like Rise Against or whatever, they still like mostly, I think some of the guys probably look like normal or whatever, but for the most part, they're like still kind of cool.
What is
in
this
an probably an unattainable way for most of their listeners, whereas like you can literally everyone who listens to The Offspring is exactly as cool as Dexter. And that's like, and that's actually really punk. That's like way more punk. Like that's the true ethos of punk, right? It's like, here's three chords, now go start a band. There's no difference between you and me. Like that, Dexter Holland is the only punk, because you don't. You know, Mark Hoppus, Tom DeLonge, Travis Barker. Can you relate to these people? Do they look like you? Do they look like people you know?
I mean, if Dexter Holland looked like me, I would have to really do some soul search. I would have to think about whether or not I was the addressee of the ascertainment of the Verily Suicide song. let's check out an acoustic version from Bruno. This is Bruno Maciel doing an acoustic version of Behind Your Walls from The Offspring. Kind of slowing it down a little bit. I think he's got a framed puzzle on his wall behind him. That's kind of cool.
Really, really proud of that puzzle.
Good work, Bruno. I mean, a lot of the water looked like it was the same color, so that would have been tough.
Ashley's doing a puzzle right now where it's like a lot of, it's all browns.
Oh, yeah.
She's struggling. I don't think she'll put it up on the wall when it's done.
Especially like in the middle of the family room, like the main,
yeah.
The only thing on the wall is this puzzle, which also, unless Bruno is a very large man, I feel like that's like a 500-piece puzzle.
Yeah,
it's really true. Not.
Sorry. I'd also just think about the fact that like you and I are about to talk about an Offspring album that we don't like for 4 hours, and I'm like, if Ashley tried to put a puzzle on the wall, I'd be like, that's silly.
So that's Bruno's version, and then here's this, this guy's name is Tapak, and then his last name is like Russian characters. He looks like he's not wearing a Bluetooth headset, but his outfit and ponytail scream. He just is a Bluetooth headset, if you know what I mean. He's wearing like a nice lime green dress shirt tucked into trousers with a high belt and a very tight slicked back pony. And he's doing a drum cover of this song. I mean, he looks incredible. I guess he kind of is wearing Bluetooth. He's wearing like off-brand AirPods. You can hear the studio version of the song if you didn't do the Bad Times Challenge. It sounds fucking insane. He's chewing gum. Like, this guy's a mall kiosk punk. That's what we... Maybe we have figured them out.
Well, yeah, maybe, yeah. You know what? We're actually smart.
Why is there, like, a dried fish on the wall? Tell me. I love his drum technique also. It's like dead armed.
He looks like a puppet. Like he's playing like one of the what was the show with the puppets, you know, and they're you know, looks like a Team America puppet.
Absolutely. He kind of looks like he had a nap right before and somehow managed to sleep on both of his arms, so they both have pins and needles.
Right. Right, so you're just sort of having to use the whole arm. Wow, that is the most unique technique I've seen. And also the bright green button up, the whole thing.
What an interesting man, Tupac. So, you know, obviously I love Tupac, even mm-hmm. more than Tupac. So that's my final thought on Behind Your Walls. Like, piece of shit song, but it's fun to talk. It's fun. I'm thankful for things like this. So, you know, that's all I can really say.
Well, and I'm glad we resurfaced Mall Kiosk Punk, because you're right. That might be the big insight of these 2 months. And if that's it, that's fine. If it took us this many hours to get there.
Even though we probably said it like episode 3 and just forgot.
Yeah, and totally. We're like, oh, that's actually pretty insightful.
And that's like been the thing for 5 years. It's like, we'll talk for 5 hours and then we'll be like, you know, it's usually you will say, I think we really actually touched on something in there. And it's like, we just touched on, like, it's kind of bad, but good.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's sort of like Blink-182 is like sick, even when they're not. You're like, that's like pretty really tight.
Touched on something.
We're really quite insightful.
Oh my
just two
God.
Smart dudes who know how to pronounce poignant. I've been criticized.
Army of One is the next episode that we're doing.
Oh yeah.
So this is for this one. I wrote down. I feel like the drums had like kind of a krautrock vibe at the start, which was I hated because I actually don't really like krautrock to begin with, but especially when it's in this kind of context. And then I think it started sounding like The Cult, who might have come up before. I think. Maybe
we keep saying something. We're like, this sounds like The Cult,
which to me just means
it's
think it sounds
sound
bad.
Like Shoo Shoo.
Yes, exactly. Yes. To me, The Cult just means bad. And then I think I wrote down fake bird noises, but more specifically, it sounds like Dexter is doing like a Homer Simpson, an impression of Homer Simpson doing a seagull sound. He's like, at one point later in the song, I feel like I heard him say, caw, caw, unless like maybe there was a seagull outside my apartment, but I heard some fucked up weird bird noises. How about you?
I think they're doing so. This is the song where I was like, what is happening? Because there's very deliberate effects happening, but like not in a deliberate enough way that you're still not thrown by it. So there's like some like reverse guitar, like really. It's like Baby's First Pro Tools is sort of the vibe. Like, this was like when everyone got GarageBand and you were like, check out all these guitar sounds. And you're like, well, the guitar kind of just sounds good as a guitar. So for Army of One, I wrote, okay, here we go. It's troop time. Is it my headphones or do the guitars all sound like shit on this album? Why can't they make a guitar sound like a guitar anymore? Cool that the Offspring are coming around to the aughts garage revival. That weird hi-hat sound is the same as The Kids Aren't All Right. And I hate that I recognize it now, that which you could hear a lot in the live videos. It's the same sample. The song sounds like a shitty MP3 from 1998. I literally stopped mid-song to listen to something else to make sure it wasn't me. Was this leaked early like the Wolverine movie with no effects? And then they just never fixed it? Like, it feels really unfinished. Like, someone's like, hey, guys, something really uncool happened last night. I don't know who's responsible, but, like, you know, it's not mastered. It's not mixed. Like, this is not how we wanted you to hear the album. Right. Like, that's the energy. It has the energy of, like, what's his name? Wolverine. You know, the guy, the dancer. You know, the prestige. The prestige Wolverine guy crying. Remember when Wolverine leaked? Because he was like, it's not the movie. Like, that's how this sounds. This sounds like Wolverine crying to me. Because we're watching his movie wrong. And all the people who work so hard on it. You know, being disrespected.
Well, you know, I hate to say it, but I feel like you're a little bit all over the place with your analysis. So let's check in with Amanda London to get it more straight to the source reading of it. Army of One.
You're gonna have
by
to
the Offspring.
Me.
I got yeah. Here we go. Please. Sorry, I keep seeing so that god awful album cover over and over again in our chat. it's so bad. It's crazy. It's like
it's truly outrageous. It's outrageous what they've done.
Amanda London says, the phrase Army of One alludes to a singular individual being just as effective as an entire army. This idea is not usually meant to be taken literally. In fact, as used within the context of this song, it is premised on the notion of a person, whether it be the singer or addressee, being up against the world. Verily, even though the state of the world isn't expounded on too much, the implication is that this is a troubled one we live in. Moreover, based on the first verse, it is pretty clear that the singer has some serious interpersonal and emotional emotional issues he's dealing with, but the vocalist is challenging like-minded individuals, the brokenhearted who feel as if all hope is fading away, to dig in and focus their energies towards surviving in a productive and edifying manner. So this is another one of the Offspring's Let the Bad Times Roll songs in which they are tackling the subject of depression, even if in an indirect fashion this time around. So again, it's verily happening, this song.
I feel like this might be the most verily punk album of all time.
It's true.
Never has an album more thoroughly verily.
Here's them playing it live. I don't know where. This is uploaded by Tammy Vision. I feel like they haven't played this song live very often. But also, almost every song from this album has a music video, weirdly.
Oh, well, because remember Dexter Holland has his
Not even just lyric video. Like, most of them have, like, full-on music videos. Not just lyric videos, but, like, actual.
Oh, wow, weird. I realized I accidentally closed that window. So why am I not here?
Oh, I see.
You're doing the yelling thing where it's obvious.
This is in Paso Robles, California. I'm sure I said that correctly.
So they're, like, playing these new songs live.
Yeah, I don't think they've played this one too much, but they're... So, I mean, it still kind of sounds like the Offspring when they do it, but let's check out what... Actually, this girl kind of just keeps it the Offspring, too, but I just thought this girl's interesting because she seems very, like, Etsy. You know, she's just, like, very chuggy kind of girl with lots of pottery and pots and, like... grade 11 paintings behind her, but then she's just kind of shredding on a candy red electric guitar.
Yeah. Weird context clues in this.
The vocals sound fucked.
That's so weird.
And then here's Bergskal 666 doing an acoustic version of it. Just kind of a nice soft recording with just a camera pointed directly at his sweaty ball sack inside of his
foot.
You can smell it. It has like that sort of,
very tactile,
that vinegar smell that comes from, you know, that kind of like salt and vinegar chip smell and of sweaty balls.
Salt, you ever get that? My balls.
No. What do they smell like?
Like just earthy.
You don't get that smell where it like smells like someone opened a bag of salt and vinegar chips one room over.
No, I definitely don't. That's really, I mean, we've talked a bunch about our balls.
Yeah.
It's not like I'm not acquainted with it.
I know.
But yeah, I would never describe it that way.
Interesting. And to be fair, these sweatpants do look really clean. So I'm just kind of projecting my own ball sweat smell onto this person's,
I mean, no matter what, if I'm in a full sweatsuit like this, you know, a hoodie, sweat, like eventually I'm just getting a little musty down there.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I run hot, so
this, I don't know, it's kind of a nice cover.
It's kind of nice.
Didn't they already have a song called like Conspiracy of One or something?
Yeah, that's the name of the album. I don't know if there's a title track.
Okay,
on it.
Well, whatever.
I mean, you know what? I was gonna Google it, and then I was like, "That's not
whatever.
That's
who
not
cares?
The vibe."
What do you think of this song, "Army of One"? Final thoughts, "Army of One."
Final thought. I forgot it. We're getting into like I forgot it until we listened to the cover of it.
It seems actually pretty Offspring-y to me. I think.
Yeah,
it kind of does. Like.
Melodically, it feels like it's all there. It's that beginning, do 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 do. Like,
yeah, that's so.
That feels like stolen from something. Like,
it seems like spaghetti western vibes or something.
Yeah, exactly. it's very for a fistful of novelty songs.
So, okay.
Look at it's bad. The album's bad. I didn't like this song either.
The album's bad, but I feel like we're turning it into a classic tonight, which is maybe the problem.
That's interesting.
So,
yeah.
up next is Breaking These Bones. Now, I did write out LMAO in my notes. I think I was just knowing that I'm going to send the notes over to the Discord, and I wanted to clarify that I thought it was funny, but I wasn't actually L-ing MAO when I wrote that.
Okay.
So I apologize, but... My one note on this song, which really did actually crack me up internally, maybe I did LOL, actually. I think I did LOL when I realized Some of the guitar on this song sounds like The Rapture, which is very funny if you've heard it.
Oh, okay,
it's
cool.
It has that, like, the Rapture sellout album, but then plugged into, like, a shitty, fucking awful Offspring song. So that just is very funny to me. And then I just highlighted the lyrics that I thought were just incredible for a man in his 50s to be writing. Here in my room, my bed is my throne. Tears are the weight breaking these bones.
Yes.
What'd you think? What's your notes?
You know what? I regret how this is making me feel like maybe I got to listen to The Rapture. So I wrote, I caved and had to Google this record on this song. Kerrang called The Offspring America's most underappreciated punk band, but I also learned that Bob Rock produced it, which makes sense. This is the point at which I was like, it all kind of started to click for me why it sounds the way it does. They in the sentence is Kerrang. They also called the previous song Dead Kennedys Meets Fear, Lowell. And I probably was not lolling at this point. And then around that moment, I went, oh, wait, I think I like this song. The joke is on me.
Ooh.
So at some point, I started to think this song was like pretty good. Couldn't hum it. Don't remember why or if I liked it. But it makes sense that if this sounds like the Cello Rapture record, I would enjoy it. Like, that seems like something where I'd be like, oh, that's the one Rapture album that I think is good.
Yeah, the sellout one. Well, before we get into, there's a couple of videos to watch, but let's hear what Amanda in London has to say. Now getting midway into the playlist of Let the Bad Times Roll, we can see, as implied by the project's title, that depression is one of the sub-themes of the album, if not the main theme. And on this track, Breaking These Bones, the case the singer is suffering from has been caused by the absence of the addressee. I think at this point we need to admit that one of the best things Amanda London does is refer to the listener or the person that the singer is singing to as the addressee. I love that. I've never heard of that before being described that way.
It's really evocative. Be like, who's the addressee of this song? It's like the addressee of this podcast is just us. Like, I know that.
Yeah, exactly.
You always want to think about your addressee.
Other people are listening, but they're not the addressee. The addressee is actually ourselves. Mm. It's not even each other. It's ourselves.
Yeah. Like, this to me, this pod is simply addressed to me.
The nature of his relationship with this individual is not expounded upon, nor is it specified whether this person is alive or dead, but as a result of him or her not being around, the vocalist is afflicted with a grief so heavy that the weight of it is breaking his bones. Of course, that is an analogy of how terribly he is feeling inside, and how it is manifested in the real world is by the narrator, for instance, isolating himself in his room in complete darkness, meditating on better days past alongside the addressee. Moreover, the vocalist has even blocked his calls, and we can presume has perhaps gone offline also. So I'm getting a little confused. I'm also starting to wonder if Amanda London is a real person, but maybe somebody hired who doesn't speak English as a first language and they can pay like pennies to the dollar to crank out SEO copy. I can't tell if it's,
yeah, is it overwritten in a like teenage way? Like I've got to fill space. I'm shrinking the margins.
Saying
on this
verily
paper
all the time.
Yeah, like just I learned a couple of words that I think are smart. Or is it like being run through like Google Translate?
Yeah, no, because Google Translate wouldn't add verily and expounding to every article.
That's, you're right. That's
yeah, a
that's a big Google Translate word. Yeah.
So unfortunately, there's no live recording, but there is a live vinyl recording of the song on the record. So let's check that out.
Okay, so someone is recording their vinyl live. That's
yeah,
what that
exactly.
Means.
It's Vinyl Sounds okay. Uploading this. Oh yeah, there's these weird big chords at the start too. That's not the Rapture sound to me, but that is a very. It's almost like The Who or something.
Yeah, it's very Pete Townsend. See, but the song doesn't suck. It just sounds like a generic kind of punk song.
Well, I also just wanted to quickly show you. This is Marvin Heartless. This is a German emo reacting to the first time hearing it. So I just thought real quick.
This is not real. That's not a real German emo.
German emo first time
hey guys,
hearing Offspring.
Welcome back. It's time for the next Offspring song, Breaking These Bones. Another short song, not even 3 minutes long. And
it's kind of like a swoop hair emo
I'm
wearing a
pretty
pierce
sure
the veil.
That this is again a fast punk song. And I'm excited because
he's got Undertale's vinyl in the background.
I really loved. And the next one is up ahead. And I don't want to say anything. Let's jump right into it.
Again, it doesn't seem really good. It feels like someone's doing a bit where they're like, I dressed as an emo for Halloween.
It's like they're doing three bits at once that don't make sense, where you're like, it's like an SNL sketch where you're like, I guess they've kind of heard of Twitch before, but they don't know anything about subcultures because this character doesn't.
Like, who are they supposed to be? What is the joke here?
It's like Mikey Day has clearly been on the internet once, but what he's trying to be doesn't exist.
Exactly. And now it's just this emo German team just rocking.
Marvin Heartless.
So is it just him kind of...
I haven't checked. I have no idea. We'll have to skip ahead, I guess.
Maybe the Undertale vinyl is definitely... That's a...
that's something.
A decision.
Yeah, he's just swooping his hair.
Okay, what...
It keeps crashing for me.
Oh, this song was a little bit...
I've still got it. Don't worry.
a little bit different than the others. It's still a fast punk song, but it reminds me a little bit of the newer record, so a little bit more... Rise and Fall, Wedge and Grace, but really, really good song. Really, really good song.
Perfect.
Like I said, I love this new record. And
so
I hope... I don't know how many records Offspring will do in the next years, because Offspring are not the youngest band, you know that.
Wow, body.
But I hope if
not
they will
the
bring
band.
Out new records in the future...
These old men.
They don't change back to... the last record, so they will stay this way, because
so I guess
this
one's
exactly
better than
what I
want
to hear from Offspring. And
so the German, I mean, I feel like personally I don't think I could add any better final thoughts on Breaking These Bones than the German emo after his
first. The German emo I think speaks for the pod.
So that means the next one to get to is Coming For You, which I think is the one that you're saying they've been recording the album forever. Like, this was a standalone single that became like a WWE entrance song. It said on Wikipedia that they toured the world for this song. And I guess that version on the album is slightly different than the one that was released as a single before. I've just written down that it has really bad vibes for like a shuffle. And it made me appreciate Blink's edging more. They pulled off the shuffle. Usually shuffles are so bad. And this one is a perfect example of that. And then I thought... it'd also be worth pointing out just how bad the chorus is, which is breakdown, takedown, now it's on, sold out, blowout, Donkey Kong. Well, no, hell
okay.
No. What you gonna do when they keep coming for you? That's the real
so good
chorus.
It's so good.
So you like this one?
Well, no. So what I wrote is, does he say Donkey Kong in the chorus? I'm not checking. This is like if the most boring era of Green Day was worse. I'm having such a bad time, which I wrote before remembering that this was the album's title. So congrats. Okay. He definitely says Donkey Kong.
Well,
like this is the moment where it flipped for me, and I knew it because it was like that Breaking the Bones song. I was kind of like, I don't hate this. Like I'm not going to listen to it again, but you know, does it sound that different than things that I like? Like not really. You know, I got a laugh out of Dead Kennedys meets Fear. That's fine. And then this thing happened, and I was like, I hate. And I like looked, and I was like, there's several songs left, and like worse songs are coming.
See, I was,
and I was like, there's no way I'm hearing Donkey Kong right. And then when I realized, like, and then I was like, okay, he definitely saying Donkey Kong. I was just like, this is too stupid. It's too dumb. It's not funny to be this bad.
So, there's also a music video for this song where there's like rodeo clowns like killing each other or something. Like there's a lot of money behind the Offspring Donkey Kong song that appears to not have anything to do with Donkey Kong. Let's see what Amanda Lennon has to say first. The Offspring's Coming For You is an interesting song, which we can say is dual themed, at least to some extent. It starts off with the Offspring giving a shout out to themselves in a humorous sort of way, or more the point they had reached a place in their career trajectory where maybe they were just not as inspired to make music as passionately as they had in times past. So I guess this one is less of a lyrical thing and more kind of about the background of the song. But then it says, you know, for example, in the second verse, Holland implies that the hopelessness of the masses is being caused by the economic powers that be. And while our dreams are being deaded, They are rather cheering up above, maybe going a bit out on a limb for a second, which inspired him to express such a view. Is the age-old rich getting richer adage a reality, which is still very true to this day? There's a header here that says, is coming for you a resistance song? And Amanda writes, it may also be above the upon idea, i.e. some sort of mass depression attributable to the powers that be upon which a previous track on this album's playlist, Army of One, is based. But as for coming of you, it's not a resistance song. Rather, if anything, it's a song of enlightenment and what the listener is intended to be made aware of is something like you can sleep if you want to, but while you're playing docile, those in control of the world are figuring out ever-increasing ways to exploit you. So hopefully that clears up
what the song is. That's good. Now it definitely makes sense to me, for sure. I get that.
I just couldn't resist. Completely. Whenever I could get acoustic, I just couldn't resist. So this is them doing it acoustically on Comp.
Offspring.
92.3.
Comp?
Like, how do you even write a song like this, honestly? If you've been playing music for like 40 years, how do you write a song that sounds like this and not accidentally write something better?
Can you not? What is this? The sound? Oh my god. Oh fuck, hold on, I gotta take off my headphones again. It sounds like a rusty song. That's what that sounds like. It sounds like Empty Cell. Which is, Bob Rock has probably heard Rusty. I think, this feel like this is exactly what you write if you're in some kind of monster? Like.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, it actually kind of makes perfect sense.
This acoustic version of it, too, sounds like they are just making it up by accident on their lunch break.
Yeah, oh, like, what if we, like, wrote a grimy blues
song?
So
as we go deeper, I think I'm realizing I do hate noodles. I really don't like noodles at all.
That's not, I know, noodles is cool.
I don't like noodles. I think I like Dexter better somehow, which is insane to me.
No, it's so, a pro noodles pod.
The other thing that you're going to enjoy learning is that there was a, when this first came out before the album, there was a cover challenge for this song.
Yes.
So I didn't write down too many, but I wrote down, you know, five covers of this that we can check out. This one.
Okay. Well, wow, that's so reasonable of you.
Actually, I'm going to save that one because it's fucking incredible. Let's check out Urfa 90 first. This is Urfa 90 contributing to the covers challenge of Coming For You by The Offspring with his one-man band. Here we go. So that clown in the middle is from the music video, I think.
Oh, okay. Horrible. Horrifying.
Some crazy synths in this. Maybe like...
That's what... These are in the song?
Are they?
Oh, wow, yes. No, I thought that's what you were... I wasn't sure. I'm asking you.
I don't think so. I think this Urfa has added it. I mean, this is so weird, because inevitably these, like, home recording nerds usually sound kind of like the Magnetic Fields. But then adding, like, nasty new Depeche Mode synths is giving it really sinister vibes, especially with this evil clown in the middle.
Donkey Kong.
What does that mean? So this was Paul Just, and I just wanted to play Paul Just because of how weird this lamp is, mostly. I mean, that's a fucking weird-looking lamp. And he just did, like, a horse bray when he sat down. Did you see that? Trying to, like... That's, like, the equivalent of being, like, I'm... You know, sorry, I did a bad take. I wasn't in the right space. Like, to sort of seem nonchalant, to sit down and do a full-on bray.
Wow. My man Brayin.
He has, like, a IT guy goatee and spiked hair. Like, I think if
you... I can't believe how much this sounds like... Oh, it's misogyny. That's what it sounds like.
So that's Paul Just. I hate the hey. A couple more. This is Rayjean St. Pierre. I mean, this guy is mostly for us. This is a visual of an incredible, I think must be Quebecois boomer who has like his little guitar nook. With a cutout of a guitar on a wall that looks homemade.
What an amazing nook.
And then he just cool like note. Steps in. He's a fucking pimp. Yes. He looks like Ron McLean.
Jeffrey Tambor.
Yeah, he looks like Ron McLean and Jeffrey Tambor.
Oh, this is cool.
This guy's got to be like in his 60s. And he's wearing a chain over like a some sort of breathable wetsuit type of shirt. He's a bald man in his nook. He's killing it. He's having the best night of his life.
Oh, this is great. See, this makes me like the song.
His wife is like angrily trying to watch The Voice in the other room, and he's shredding.
Oh yeah. What? It kind of sounds like it also sounds like they're trying to do that AWOL Nation song, like any one of those, like
yeah, exactly. But also, it sounds kind of like new Marilyn Manson, I think, or like new meaning anything past like 1994 or whatever. Like it has like that kind of vibe too, I guess. This is a band called Elderberry doing a very rockin' cover. This is the sickest shit. This is uploaded by Al Scher Video, I guess. The cover band Elderberry, which is such a gross name.
Just hate that.
They're so sick, Elderberry. The most British drummer ever.
But it was time to like, go so... and get our
keys.
So the guitar player and the drummer are both wearing shirts with the Union Jack on it, but they're different shirts. And then the bass player has an American flag on his shirt. And the singer has just got an energy.
The singer is almost impossible to describe.
The singer is sort of like, what if Cyndi Lauper like was bad?
Yeah, like, what if Cyndi Lauper
evil
like
Cyndi Lauper?
What if Cyndi Lauper hung out at the Viper Room?
Yeah, totally.
I love her accent though. It's beautiful. Beautiful. And then she... Do you still like the song?
Yes, I like it more now.
Well, you're gonna love it now. This is Canal Colegio La Milagrosa Talavera. This is an elementary school class singing the whole song for the cover challenge. So, I mean, it's hard to argue with that. As you'll see.
I bet it's going to be magical. So, do you think the teacher was just a big Offspring fan? Because there's definitely, like, an older guy here. It's... By older,
it must
I mean,
be. Like,
younger than us.
Unless, like, unless...
School of Music, it's very unsettling.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Also, the teacher can barely play guitar.
Yeah.
Has it been translated? Such an unsettling sound.
It's actually more unsettling than Wayne in School Music.
I really hope that someone did listen to the entire 40 minutes and then now are coming up to 70 minutes and like the halfway point on the album with us.
Yes, for sure. Oh yeah, we haven't even got to your favorite song yet.
I know.
It's a big moment. It's like the damn it episode of this concept.
Exactly. So what do you think of Coming For You by The Offspring?
Well, it's interesting that this song is Coming For You because we're about to enter a world where it seems like no one is coming.
That's great tease for the... Yeah, I mean, I hate this one, to be clear. To be very clear, any kind of like jock jam shuffle rock I usually hate, and this is a perfect example of how bad it always is.
I mean, this really was the point in... This is the point in the song where I started to have a bad time, and this is probably the point in the episode where I'm going to start having a bad time. So that's appropriate.
So the next song is We Never Have Sex Anymore. And
this was originally... We were just going to do this song, right?
Well,
the episode was only going to be about this song.
Actually, my thought was initially we were going to do Let the Bad Times Roll, but then just sneak this one in the whole time because there wouldn't have been enough to talk about. And before I realized we just need to really... crack it all, let all the light in, really, and shine it on our souls and see what we find.
Yeah.
this song, my note for this song First of all, like, it's so fucking bad. It's terrible. It, like, lyrically, it's awful. It's not even clever. The concept of being, like, an old guy complaining that he doesn't have sex anymore, like, it could be, like, a Ronnie Dangerfield-style bit or something. Instead, there's lyrics like, used to do it constantly, used to have a ball, is what he says. My one note on this song. So musically, you know, there's like a lot of horns. It's kind of like, well, actually, let me tell you what Dexter said first. He said that song existed just as a guitar song for a while. Then we started putting piano on it. I'd call it a swing song. I mean, we've got a clarinet at the end and crazy stuff. It was really fun musically to do it. I know it's coming out of left field for us, but we always try to throw a curveball on every record, something that you wouldn't expect. Maybe it's punk to not be punk, is what Dexter said. So don't be saying shit like that at this point. Good Lord. My one note on this is that I think that...
That is sort of what I was saying earlier about how he looks, though. So maybe I know. Maybe Dexter and I are really finally, melded.
But my one note on this is that this song sounds like what I'm pretty sure I imagine Mariachi El Bronx sounds like.
Oh, wow.
What about you?
What about me? I have some deep... it's fine. okay, so for We Never Have Sex Anymore, I wrote, worse than I remember, probably because I've only watched it with the monkey video. So like, it is substantially worse when you're just focused only on how it sounds. So listless, it sounds like a band who's actively embarrassed by what they're doing, which is a positive. I'm so depressed, why did my life lead me here?
That's true.
Because, like, just the idea of, like, sitting down and, like, paying attention to this song.
It's so upsetting.
It's so, like, it's not even, like, because that's the thing is it doesn't even sound like they're having fun with it. Like, it's not, like, a winking, like, hey, we're middle-aged guys, like, singing about middle-aged guy stuff. Instead of singing about the opioid crisis or whatever they're so evidently qualified to sort of address. It's just... Like, it sounds disgusting. Like, it sounds so disgusting, but it just sounds like the vocal delivery is just bored. Like, it just feels like they were like, well, we got to do a joke song, and, like, here's an idea. Like, I picture this being a situation where, like, Bob Rock is, again, like,
let's
probably
do a joke
too
song.
Involved.
Yeah, you hate Bob
yeah.
Rock. Well, you know, I don't think it's that depressing to overanalyze lyrics because... Our friend Amanda London over at songmeaningsandfacts.com has done just that, and I think it's one of the best interpretations of a song I've ever seen now.
Oh, great. Amanda feels like – Amanda really is the third host. There's times where I felt like – there's people that we like, you know, that are really involved, and I feel like have done some heavy lifting and from time to time. You know, you're like, they really are. But no one more than Amanda.
There's no one I've ever wished so badly was not clearly a fake name or a bot.
yeah, like there's like can you go with an English sounding name, Amanda London.
Amanda London writes, "We Never Have Sex Anymore is one Offspring song in which the title is quite literal. What the narrative centers on is a relationship that is still intact, all right. For instance, the singer and his lady, the addressee, apparently reside together. Moreover, she prepares him dinner nightly. With which all things we can say is a true show of commitment. Which all things we can say is a true show of commitment. However, as indicated, they never have sex anymore. And whereas the vocalist does miss the days of constant lovemaking, it isn't like he's necessarily fiending at the moment." I don't know what that means. Fiending. Is that a word?
I was thinking, like, he's fiending? Like, what?
Rather, the lack of bumping and grinding is indicative of a bigger issue in this romance. And that is the addressee has become such that she no longer displays emotion, whether good or bad at all. So it's almost as if, excuse our expression, the singer is living with a robot who just performs house chores. Indeed, what he is in fact fiending for is any show of sentimentality on her regard, even if it is emotional strife. Is fiending a word, Sam?
Yeah, fiending is a word. So what it means what I would associate with as I would say fiending, to say the same thing, obsessive craving, usually for drugs and alcohol. So to
Amanda
me, that word
London
is fiending.
Actually, maybe Amanda London is reading like a bot just because she's so verbose is the thing. She knows like four words, fiending, expounding, Verily.
I kind of wonder if fiending versus fiending is like a regional thing, and I hope this is, if people have better knowledge than me, perhaps we could talk about this in the Discord.
I wonder if anyone's still listening. Fiending and
fiending both are basically the same definition on Urban Dictionary, but to me, fiending always made more sense because it's like you are a fiend for this illicit substance that you are craving.
In fact, we can even put forth that he not only misses the sex, but also getting into a good old-fashioned confrontation with his lover every now and then. And whereas this all may come off as being quite humorous based on the way we're presenting it, anyone who has actually been through such an ordeal would likely sympathize with what the narrator is going through. A person not caring either way is more or less a sign that they are no longer in love. Meanwhile, there's no indication that he or she wants this relationship to end. Moreover, this is not the type of character she displayed when they initially found love. Yet he seems unable to definitively ascertain why she has changed. So the highlight of his lament may in fact be a lack of sex, but in a way, we can replace the word sex in the title with love. It would still be the same within the grand scheme of the narrative. Now scrolling down the summary of the song. The narrator and his lover are no longer bonking. And that seems to indicate that she has fallen out of love altogether. God damn.
Amanda London, come through. I mean, I'm just, this is an Amanda London fan podcast at this point. This is a London 155. I mean, my God.
So Dexter was just fiending for a bonking, and he just didn't get it. So that's really the sad thing. So let's check out this live version. I feel like I don't know what this is, okay? This is uploaded by something called Tara Tata, and it's the Offspring / Samaha. We never have sex anymore. I think it says excerpt 2021. This is from mytaratata.com. This is them performing it with someone named Samaha. Guess.
Yeah, he looks dead-eyed. I don't think he likes doing this.
I don't know. He gave a little knowing grin that he thinks
set.
Is funny.
This is the same set. This is
what we saw in Sharaplonk, right?
Yeah, Chuck-a-plonk.
But is Samaha from Chuck-a-plonk, or is this a different?
Maybe, I don't know. Samaha, Chuck-a. Yeah, Samaha Sam is in Chuck-a-plonk. Chuck-a-plonk.
So yeah, another Chuck-a-plonk. And Chuck-a-plonk is Francais? Is that right?
Chuck-a-plonk is oui. Okay. Oh, appropriately enough, a little bit of foreshadowing.
Yeah, a little bit of foreshadowing.
Maybe that's,
Well, we'll get to that in this segment, actually. But here's an alternate punk version of the song made by
Never have sex anymore.
Yosuke Cavalcante Modesto.
Like we did. So long ago.
This is like the future idiot version.
I guess so, but I can't even tell if it's the original vocal track or if it's some kind of.
I feel like it has this, having recently stripped out the vocals from edging, I feel like it has that weird sound.
It kind of works.
It actually does work.
Let's check out an acoustic version. This is by Take Your Pants Off Music. Not Take Off Your Pants, Take Your Pants Off Music. It's like a...
We never have sex anymore.
A troublingly old guy.
On the floor like we did.
Honestly, so long ago, I feel like this is going to be something that Matthew Good uploads, a video like this, in like 2 years.
Never want to even score like
this is where things are headed.
So long ago.
But he has like a
jersey up on the wall.
Yeah, like it's like real basement lurker, old guy vibes. But he has like a fancy looking board and PA also. It's really confusing me.
I don't understand the context here.
I'm noticing though that there is a good chord progression buried in here.
There's a what?
There's a good chord progression in this song. So here's a bass cover by Bass Morgado. I don't remember why I put this on the list. Oh yeah, it's just a good. That's why. This is like a cool ass guy.
Yeah.
He put the song in the Toy Story logo. It's just
okay. The song's actually this cool guy just taking it for a walk in his sunnies.
Again, like he seems like he's older than us, this guy. Oh, he's doing little moves? Sick. To be honest, I thought there'd be more covers, but finally, there's this Giovanni Piccioni's. I feel like he's doing some guitar solos on it. And he has more of like a kind of like seems like he's a lawyer or something. His office.
Oh, what is yeah. this putting on the Ritz ass song?
Giovanni shredding.
Giovanni, yeah, yeah. Like, it truly bringing. This is the excitement that the original is lacking.
I mean, okay. So you listen to the deluxe version. I did not know this was coming at the end, but I think
shocking, a real shocking, because I don't speak enough French to know.
Based on the song title, right?
En français.
And I was I was also, to be honest with you, I was kind of like, why the fuck doesn't Amanda London have an entry for this song? At that point in the album, I was like, I was going London first to get my, you know, to shape my opinion.
I mean, as the pod is, yeah.
Exactly. So I was shocked, but I mean, I don't know how to even pronounce this. I'm not even going to try, actually. It's too embarrassing. My neighbor's
Guirsou Couverture.
Exactly. That's what it is. So this is, there's an en français version of the song, a full French version of We Never Have Sex Anymore.
Full French.
They've gone full French with it. So you're thinking that it might be because of Chaka Ponk.
Maybe they're big in
In France.
But what is that? There's no way that that's the same.
I also think, but here's the thing. They've also been touring with Simple Plan a lot around this album. And they are I would assume they're big in Quebec because they seem like the kind of band that would be. Maybe Simple Plan was like, yo, my name's Pierre. Obviously, you should do a French version of it.
Interesting.
But either way.
The translation, by the way, would you like to know the translation?
I would love to. No, it's not.
So the translation is Undercover War.
What? Wait, that's actually a way funnier title. Also.
It's a way funnier title. I think it's almost one of the lyrics, but like, you know, I don't know.
Who cares? Comes from umusic.ca, which I believe is Sam wrote this probably, right?
I wrote this. So yeah, if you scroll down to the byline, you'll see that this is my handiwork.
SoCal.
And that's why I don't have the job anymore.
Also there's a TikTok logo on the 7-inch. So maybe this was big on TikTok or something. I don't know. There's an Offspring green 7-inch that has We Never Have Sex Anymore and the French version of it. It's insane. So here's what Dexter said in the press release. The band's frontman, Dexter Holland, committed to the new version of the song by taking French lessons to make it sound as authentic as possible. On recording the French version, Holland said, "The song is about lamenting a lost relationship or still being in a relationship that's not quite there anymore. The passion is gone, and passion is very French." Passion is very French. I don't know how to explain it, but I feel passion when I'm in France, in a good way. When we wrote the song, I just thought, this needs to be done in French. There's no other way, so we did. So that's his explanation. Okay. Is the I would just be like, let's not include that quote had to be in here. Let's just not include that quote, maybe.
There's like a reason for this, and the fact that did you just happen to find the umusic.ca link?
Yeah, I was just Googling the song.
Is there something to
this? I do like him saying the song is about lamenting a lost relationship or still being in a relationship that's not quite there anymore. It seems very French because it's when you present it that way, it does kind of seem like an Eric Romare film or something. I could see the Frenchness in that distillation of it. But I have
I'm literally going full galactic brain here and asking, like, did only the Canadian version of this have it? And is this some, like... is there some weird tax or factor thing here that we're missing where it's like, did they put out a French version? Because I'm only seeing it in the umusic.ca.
It's true. Okay, let me take a quick look at Discogs.
So I'm really, like, I'm just a little curious.
No, well, Concord Records, is that...
what is that?
That's American label. Oh, you know, and that's not the TikTok logo. Oh, my God. The Concord Records logo is basically the TikTok logo. I feel like they should sue them.
Funny.
So it's not it's not a TikTok thing. I don't think there's any way we could ever possibly understand why this happened. But touring with Simple Plan, collaborating with Shaka Ponk a lot. Definitely these are good
Shaka
reasons.
Shaka Ponk.
All I know is that I did find somebody doing a guitar cover of the French version. So this is not Ready to Die. I'm doing Guerre sous couverture.
Also, wow, that Concord Records logo is the TikTok.
I mean, this is the best episode we've ever done.
Just covering this on guitar is so funny.
Oh, that's zoom.
Wow.
Big zoom.
So, with the En Francais version, how do you feel about We Never Have Sex Anymore?
I just hate this world. How about you?
I don't know. I actually feel like I'm becoming more obsessed with this song and this band now, because I feel like there's like so many threads that are just like, in fact, as I'm talking, I thought my brain was zooming in on the video, but it is doing a fake zoom.
I mean, we did this, like, we just assume that everyone knows this, and I know everyone does, because when this single was released, the video is two monkeys.
We'll talk about that later. We are going to talk about
that. Demos? Oh, we're still talking about it. Okay,
don't worry. We have, in addition to finishing the whole album, we also have a guest this week. We're going to talk about the music video.
Okay, because so. I was like, we shouldn't just miss...
The music video is crucially important, but you can't listen to the guest spot if you haven't listened to the whole album right, so and episode.
There's going to be another pause, a necessary pause in this episode to come.
Sam, I'm not joking. I have some actual breaking news. This is not.
You don't. You
this
don't.
Is not a
don't,
bit.
Don't.
We didn't do.
Okay, it's
news.
Not a bit.
Wait,
sure.
It's this. Listen, I'll tell you when I'm doing a bit.
I'm listening. I have no choice.
I'm telling you.
Do anything else.
I'm 100% that bit. Is what I would say right now if I was going to be doing a bit. This is real breaking news. It was sent to me while I was eating dinner in the brief. I mean, fuck, I shouldn't have admitted it out loud, but we have, despite us telling you all to listen to the full album, which we both did today, we've still been uninterrupted. We've been still been kind of spending, I would say at this point, a good 12 hours thinking and talking about let the band times roll.
But of course, 155 is, you know, we like to joke around about our politics, but we are a union podcast, and so there is a mandated break for dinner while we talk. Like there's a meal break that is sort of part of our
155 union. That would be a cool logo for a bunch of people.
It would look good.
No, but for real, you know, we are also until today a staunchly anti-cop podcast. However,
I need
some details because I need to know what happened. This is breaking news that was sent to me. I can't remember by whom.
Are you going to ask me questions?
This is from the dailyhive.com/Vancouver. Uh-huh. The Abbey PD, that's Abbotsford Police Department, Abbey PD officer... punches man in face outside Offspring concert.
This is
breaking news from today.
Is this the exception that proves the rule, maybe?
I just need to know what kind of guy.
Who
was he punching? Was he punching an Offspring? Was he punching someone because they like the Offspring? Because that makes me, you know, maybe there are some good boys in blue out there.
Defending us from Offspring fans.
So the story here from Daily Hive, an Abbotsford Police Department officer was caught on video punching a man in the face outside a concert this weekend, and the incident is now under review by the force's professional standards section. The officer punched
the cop.
The man
was definitely off duty and at the Offspring show. It's definitely an Offspring fan who's a cop.
Well, there's
a normal person.
You can see the still, though. There's actually like six cops. Like someone's holding the guy back and punching him.
Oh, I didn't realize there was a link here. Oh, wow.
Yeah, like there's still, according to the police, officers were dealing with one concert goer when the unrelated man interjected and began to interfere with the investigation. The man apparently ignored police direction to disengage, and officers arrested him for obstruction. Part of the incident was caught on camera by witness Marty Gates. Onlookers can be heard saying the man did nothing and that police went after the wrong guy. The cop grabbed him from behind and choked him out. A man is heard saying off camera as police bring the man lying on the sidewalk back to his standing position. I mean, I don't know if we need to watch a police incident video in here, do we?
But no, it's fine. But that quote is pretty good.
That's a quote. I kind of do want to hear. How long is this video? Let's.
Is it in the? Because you know, I just. Yeah, how strong do you think an accent it is?
Yeah, where it's gonna be. I think we should risk it. Honestly,
yeah.
Just
do
in
it,
case.
Let's do
okay,
it.
let's see. So this is from Daily Hive News.
Let's see. What's that? Yeah.
Is there any some good? The cops are harassing him. I can't hear you. The cops are harassing, like on the hard pan.
Just to be clear, the guy who's like, "What are you doing?" is like, like 60, gray hair, just being like, "What the fuck are you doing there?" Which is great.
Yeah, take
so
the guy out, fucking put him in a fucking headlock. Yeah.
These guys are just walking by, right?
I have no idea.
Put him in a fucking headlock, eh?
This fucking cop just grabbed him from behind, fucking choked him out.
Choked him out. This is probably how we sound.
This is exactly how we sound.
Because he fucking pushed his way down to the cop. I didn't even do anything.
So just to clarify, this is there's only a little bit longer. The quote that's been pulled for this article is clearly by this man talking. And the quote the quote he said hasn't appeared yet, but he's already said so many things they could. I just love that they chose what they chose for the article.
Yeah. Really, that accent is like truly it's better than I would have hoped for.
Maybe we need to tell them what they're looking for, because now that we know what the accent is, or should we let him say it?
Let's just let him say it. Let's let him say the line.
I mean, when he gets to the start of it, I'll pause and I'll let everyone know. Just because I want it to be clear what we're looking for.
Typical fucking cops, man.
That's not even it. Typical fucking cops, man.
Hey, what a fucking girl. Hey, I got that on camera, you piece of shit.
That's part of it. Hey, I got that on camera, you piece of shit, and here's
you
the rest
of
it.
Shit.
I don't fucking care. Fuck. Punching them right in the fucking face.
He's innocent.
What a fucking goof.
You got the
winner.
YouTube!
YouTube! We is that the Abbotsford version of yelling world star? Oh my god!
You're gonna be famous, you fucking goof.
You're gonna be famous, you fucking goof.
So, to be fair, the Daily Hive did not accurately transcribe that, but. So that's breaking news.
Wow.
Man. Fucking goof.
So, unfortunately, though, I hate to say it now that I've seen the video. Like, I thought maybe, you know, maybe this was one for the cops, but once again.
Yeah, they're fucking goofs. They're fucking goofs punching an innocent guy. You fucking goof.
A-cab baby. All right, well, great.
Oh, my God. What a night, my friend. Now we get to talk about...
Now we're into, like, police violence. I mean, this is...
As we talk about... I don't know why this... I feel like I'm disassociating. Track 8 is for some reason...
Abby PD is committed to obtaining all information which led to the use of force in this situation. What information... Like it's literally just a cop hauling off and punching a guy who's, like, too drunk to respond in the...
If he was
twice.
Wearing an Offspring shirt, I still would have sided with the cops, but I can't see what kind of...
I guess, but he wasn't. He was wearing an Offspring shirt.
He was wearing a plain shirt, so...
Man, cops. Just once again, if you're a cop, if anyone in your life is a cop, like that you've chosen to be in your life as a cop, please do not listen to the podcast.
Yeah,
please don't.
You're not welcome.
Please just...
And also because we're scared of you. Because we don't want you to punch
us. Yeah, you can punch me, man. I can't... I'm
a fucking goof. All right, well, let's...
But you're a goof.
As if we're not already in the weirdest headspace, let's talk about the next track, which is track 8, an inexplicable cover of In the Hall of the Mountain King, which is a piece of orchestral music composed by Edvard Grieg in 1875 as incidental music.
You know
it's
to hear
of
it even if you don't recognize that
Ibsen's
phrase. Yeah.
1867 play, Peer Gynt. Why is this here? So this... I can almost understand it as like a sort of like maybe 90s ephemera. Maybe they only ever played it live or like it was a warm up for the guitar tech. Or
funny little intro. Yeah.
The fact that it's also right after We Never Have Sex Anymore and right before a song called The Opioid Diaries. What are they doing? What the fuck are you doing?
Nothing about this record makes sense. Like, it's so, but the idea of, like, I guess they needed something to transition to the opioid diaries. And so they just go with this, like, hokey piece of classical music. Like, it's very, and hokey's maybe not, but I feel like hokey is maybe the.
Well, it's also like, you know, something like this you'd hear maybe, I don't know, Yngwie Malmsteen do like a, or like Joe Satriani do like an intense, like multi-tiered shredding version. But it's like Noodles is just kind of okay at guitar. It's not like he does anything impressive. There's like guitar minis at the end, but there's nothing else real. Like, it's just like a fairly straightforward punk version of it. Here's a live something. I don't know if this is them playing it live or what. Yeah, it is. It's him playing it live. This is uploaded by Secret Clown. This is a year ago, actually, at the Birmingham Resorts World Arena, wherever that is. Ooh, adding a lot of pinch. But they have, like, see how...
Wedding with a pre-recorded track of a video of himself.
Yeah, but, like, look how big that screen is. Like, they're not playing small shows. It does sound very Offspring-y, kind of.
Yeah, that's true.
See, there's some guitar minis.
But there's not a second guitar player on stage, right? So it's just him doing, like, shredding stuff with a cartoon of himself. It's so...
so weird.
So weird. Deeply strange. Not unpleasant to listen to.
And also, the cartoon is actually just like an animated GIF. There's no...
Yeah.
Oh, and then it cuts to... Offspring are just really living in their own world. He's memorized what the animation does. He's memorized what the animation does so he can copy it. That was kind of cool. I thought for the sake of a cover, we could have the Seattle Symphony do it for a second.
Yeah, because this is them. So this is the Seattle Symphony covering the Offspring.
Exactly.
Did you make any notes about this?
I didn't know what to say. I had no clue what to say.
So my only note is I refuse to dignify this with a real thought.
So is that your final thought about it? I guess I was disappointed that Amanda also didn't mention it. Amanda London.
Oh, Amanda didn't write about it? Well, I bet she's got some thoughts on the next track.
Does she ever?
Mm-hmm.
I guess I'll just let this keep playing in the background. When we mentioned the next track is called The Opioid Diaries. My only note is just that I love the line that leads the chorus. It's like, so the song is obviously about the opioid crisis. Through the Offspring's trademark nuance that they're known for. That's Nuancels, the guitarist. So I guess what I love about it is that they just talk about Big Pharma a lot and stuff, but the main line of the chorus is, "Come on, Sean, you're on drugs." Like, why did you choose the name Sean? It's such a weird name. It's such a, like... Not, it doesn't feel specific, fictional enough.
Sean.
Come on,
so,
Sean.
So my note is no, please no. Why does Brian think he's in a position to capture these kinds of stories? He clearly thinks it's part of his job or what people look to the band for. Although I did look at the lyrics and Brian is confirmed hashtag resistance. Wish this was the guy who wrote any of the songs on Americana or Ixnay. Because I feel like...
But it is the guy.
Credit where credit's due. Like, no, but it's very explicitly. But you don't think so?
Because The Kids Aren't All Right is like just a multiple versions of "Come on, Sean, you're on drugs" or whatever. Like, it's like,
no. But I feel like The Kids Aren't All Right is very much like about, like, someone had promise, but then they dropped out of school and had kids. Or someone, like, had promise, but then they started smoking weed. And this story literally is like, very explicitly, because it's not subtle, says the lyric is something like, they're not junkies, even if that's what the news tells you. Hold on, what is the lyric?
Yeah, it's something like that. They use the word junkie.
They're just
a
kids
lot.
Who got in over their heads or whatever. I mean, it's like, I'm not saying it's good. All I'm saying is the thing that sucks about going back and revisiting Americana and Ixnay, and I mean, I guess to some extent, Smash is like, and probably any other song in their catalog, is that it comes from this, like, incredibly cynical place of like we talked about, it's like Walla Walla, a song about going to jail, is just about someone who like can't stop themselves from stealing cars. Like, it isn't about the fact that like, wow, someone might feel like they have to steal a car.
Is that
because
an Offspring
of these other
song?
Factors.
We didn't talk about that one. You must have been talking to other people about the Offspring. Who have you been talking about the Offspring about?
Sorry.
What the fuck?
I'm sorry. Listen, save it. We'll talk about it after. Well, but yeah, what's the lyrics?
Come on, Sean.
I don't even want to lead. I'm not going to lead them. I'm not going to read them.
Well, let's read what Amanda London has to say.
I don't think he says, come on.
He absolutely says, come on, Sean. Amanda London writes, perhaps the simplest way to begin describing the Opioid Diaries is as it being premised on a conspiracy theory, and that is Big Pharma intentionally getting people hooked on opioids. This seems to be something they've more or less admitted to themselves, though not the intentional part. But the truth of the matter is simply this. Yes, America does concurrently have a deadly serious problem with opioids, and users are actually getting a lot of these drugs from legitimate prescriptions. So enter the Offspring. They start off by explaining that many of the kids who are labeled as junkies are being judged unfairly. That's because it's Big Pharma that hooked them in the first place. So the implication is that if anybody gets chastised for the situation, then it should be the entities who provided the drugs, not the people who became dependent on them. And now there's a special section just for Sean.
Oh, just about Sean. Can I ask a really unsympathetic and unnuanced question? And this is good because we were sort of talking earlier today in the context of Exclusi about times that you and I have grappled with ideas that we're not equipped to discuss, and that those are the times that people should be calling us out for having horrendous opinions and saying absolutely the worst possible thing. But I'm reading this charitably as like, okay, the Offspring have sort of softened a little bit in their old age towards the idea of like not looking at sort of these sorts of societal issues as being the result of individual failure and people not being individually responsible for their own behavior and their own life, and that there are larger factors at play. But is it a less sympathetic read of that we're talking about a crisis that mostly affects like the white people who presumably comprise the majority of the Offspring's audience? And in the past, when they were describing social ills, they were often quite explicitly in their own lyrics talking about racialized communities.
Right.
And therefore, does their sympathy only extend to whites? That's my question.
I mean, I think what you're getting at is Sean a white-coded name, spelled S-E-A-N? And I think there are a lot of people of color named Sean, so I think it's pretty fucked up that you would insinuate that about Sean.
I'm not trying to erase the ethnicity of Sean's of color here, and
especially
I apologize.
Right when we get to Amanda London's Sean section.
I'm sorry. So let's give it over to someone who's a little more equipped to talk about this Amanda London.
But that noted, Sean, i.e. the personification of the aforementioned kids, is being advised to dedicate his all to kicking the habit. He still has hope, and being addicted to the substance is the sooner you quit, the better type of scenario. For instance, if the opioids stop coming in, what will he turn to in their stead? Also, it's not like prolonging the inevitability of quitting will positively contribute to the situation. So the vocalist feels compelled to encourage him to quit while the time is ripe. So I like that, regardless of what, I think you do have a fairly interesting point that I'm not going to touch any further, but I think it was interesting of you to say it, for sure.
I like that. That's as far as you'll go, is that it was interesting that I said it. Thank you. Thanks for your support, man.
Look, I support you in whatever happens. I will determine where I stand alongside you, verily. I will no longer expound upon it. But I do think I like that it's about how they're saying Big Pharma has got you hooked on opioids. and what you should do is just quit them. I think that's a great
message. Yeah, yeah. It's still an Offspring song.
Why don't you just quit then?
Look, the time to quit is now.
So, thank God they really believed in this song enough that they did bust it out during their Hellfest appearance that we've watched so many times over the months. I was worried.
I've missed this. I'm so glad.
Yeah, so here they are. The Opioid Diaries. Great song title too. And it also has this like stupid sleigh bells riff at the start.
I feel like all the songs in this record have all the guitars are like jink, 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 jink. It's very sleigh bells.
Sounds insane. It sounds fucking crazy, dude. And so for some reason they believed in this song so much that also them performing it live in 2018 is the other bonus track on the deluxe edition.
Right.
Why?
Did you make any notes for this?
No, I didn't. Once I figured out what it was, I just put it with this song and turned it off. So you actually were more dedicated to the Bad Times Challenge.
I was the whole thing. Is this a bootleg? Jesus Christ. Why does it sound like this? Why is it on the album? Why are we doing this? It doesn't even sound like a board recording. Like, it sounds like a bootleg.
It sounds like they added fake crowd sounds too.
Sounds like somebody snuck like an old micro cassette recorder into the show.
This riff is so bad.
They believe in the song.
For some reason, I like how the drums sound on this recording.
I mean, I guess they're like the closest thing to a real instrument you've heard for hours.
It's true. This guy's name is Mr. Penn Noel, and I don't know. I don't remember why I put this on here, but here's a cover of the. Okay. So one thing I did notice is that there are many, many covers of this song, and everyone hits play and can't start in time, so they have to let the guitar play by itself first.
Amazing. What a great shirt.
A great shirt. Great technique. He can't even... The way that the chords are going down the 3 frets, he can't even do that.
Really just doing the all Ramones only downstrokes, though.
It's another crotch cam, too, which I like.
Yeah, he's just thinking about those salt and vinegar chips again.
This is a bass one. Same problem, I think. Well, I guess you wouldn't play bass in that part too, but I can't tell if this guy's like insanely sick and in like a Brooklyn hardcore punk, like egg punk type of band, but I think he's just like a really scary Offspring fan.
Yeah, and like, is he just doing a bit? I don't know. I don't think so.
No, I think this is not, this is too lived in to be a bit.
Because even like the haircut, like I can't tell.
I know, like the haircut is cool. He has some.
I think this is going to be really cool.
He has an Offspring sticker on the guitar. He's wearing an Offspring shirt. Great bass tone. It's so loud. One of the best tones is loud, I think. And then this one I just included because it's so... This is probably when I wrote this down, this is probably what got me thinking about those salt and vinegar chips, because this is just like
nastiest. Oh, yeah, you can smell that.
The nastiest, like...
Cuts on the leg and stuff. Oh, it's the nasty...
It's just like a nasty...
Uncovered mattress.
Uncovered mattress so with just nasty. Like a... There's like an air hole for these smooth boy legs to play.
Like looking at it.
Scent come out. It's so fucked. And it sounds so bad. It's just so... Whoa, look at that picking, though. You only get that technique if you don't waste any time washing your balls.
Oh, this is the feet. I don't like it, man.
It's so gross. So what's your final thoughts on the Opioid Diaries by the Offspring?
Well, I'm just, you know, and like I said, I'm sorry, everyone. Maybe that's, I thought better of it. I think my closing thought is just, I hope one day everyone in the niche can forgive me.
So there are bad
opinions.
There's true mini episode vibes. You had a thing where you were talking too fast because you're getting nervous about your own argument as you were doing it.
Yeah, it really is. We've gone through it all.
This next episode is definitely going to be one of those. This is a song called the Hassan Chop, and at this point I stopped writing my own thoughts because I think my own thoughts were just always the same. But I did write down a couple facts that they. Well, actually, one of them is a thought. This reminds me kind of like Tom DeLonge had this song called "My First Punk Song" on I think Boxcar Racer. It sounds like something like that, this song. It sounds like someone trying to do an impression of a punk song, and it's just, like, really fucking terrible. A little factoid in here is that they took a riff that was hidden in their old song, Call It Religion, and turned it into a full-blown song.
Damn, look at you with the facts.
It's fucking awful. Now, I don't even know where to begin with this one. I guess let's just hear your thoughts first.
Okay, so my note is similar to you. I really started to lose it around this point. I wrote, ha, 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 what the fuck is this now? This is on the same record as We Never Have Sex Anymore. I'm genuinely impressed. Who is this band for? Ha, 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 ha. And there's like a lot of, at that point, I'm really not trying. I was feeling quite goofy. And like, this is again with the sequencing on this record, like what, I also can't tell, because maybe we were all listening to the deluxe version. But I don't know if you can find the not deluxe version. Like, where is this record supposed to end?
It's supposed to end with Lullaby. It's supposed to end with Lullaby.
Okay, so then this still makes no sense.
It makes no sense. But so, this song, like, did you get an understanding of what this song is about or what it's inspired by?
Because and now I'm like looking at it and I'm like,
so
not
fucking insane. Okay, so one thing I guess we need to start with is that. How do you say this word? Caliphate? 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 How do you say that?
Caliphate, but I don't know.
There's a spoken word part where he whispers, "Caliphate destruction is a war that must be waged," which I feel like is some sort of like political commentary that he's not nuanced enough to do. And fortunately, we do have it from his own mouth. How incredibly stupid this song is, and what he's trying to go for and thread the needle with. Is so fucked up that I almost can't even believe it. But let's start with, his quote, and then we'll watch the video. So this is Dexter Holland speaking to Apple Music, Sam's favorite streamer. He says, "Someone once told me, I used to think your music was happy until I read your lyrics, but I think that's part of the formula. I wanted to write a song about what was going on in the Middle East and ISIS in particular, just how brutal it's gotten over there. It's beheadings. When I thought, oh, I see. He's saying it's beheadings. It was punctuated incorrectly. I thought he was saying it is beheadings. No, he means the beheadings that are happening. When I thought of the beheading thing, not a great start of a sentence. And I think that the way that the sentence ends is also so much worse than you could ever imagine in your entire life. I just want you to think in a moment, imagine Dexter Holland saying, when I thought of the beheading thing, and then just let that ruminate for a second and think of how you would expect the sentence to end. And then this is how it ends. It goes, when I thought of the beheading thing, I thought, oh, that reminds me of that old Bugs Bunny cartoon, Alibaba Bunny. Where the guy runs around saying Hassan Chop. So I decided to call the song that. No one knows what it is except for 50-year-old guys, but it was a great cartoon. The song is about how terrible it is over there, and not to point fingers, but to call it what it really is, a continuation of the Crusades. I mean, Jesus, it's the same stuff that's been going on for a couple thousand years. My God is right, and your God sucks, and now I'm going to kill you for it. So yes, I mean, I think not knowing much about this era of Looney Tunes and how it's been interpreted or canonized over the years, I would assume that this is probably something that Warner Brothers doesn't want to remember, that they had a cartoon called Hassan Chop something called like Alibaba Bunny.
God will this treasure, O Hassan, or the jackal shall grow fat on thy carcass. No one shall pass Hassan.
So this is Hassan, but you can hear this clip from cartoon.
Save me, pal.
Daffy comes
Save
over.
Me. Help!
Hassan, chop!
So that part, that is actually sampled at the start of the song, inexplicably. This obscure, I'm not even going to look it up. I'm just assuming this has been deleted or has a disclaimer at the start that it's because it's so offensive. And they've sampled that at the start of a song that says something about caliphate destruction is a war that must be waged. Just incredibly complex and the kind of thing that only I think Amanda London could make sense of, really.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
So Amanda London says,
get London on the track.
but this point in the playlist of Let the Bad Times Roll, listeners should know that The Offspring is a conscious band, i.e. one who is mindful of the prevailing issues of the day. And when it comes to regularly producing bad news, few regions are as consistent as the Middle East. Sorry, I didn't say it. That's Amanda London writing that. This is something which caught Dexter Holland's notice, particularly when it comes to the actions of the infamous ISIS. If that is the matter he is dealing with on Hassan Chop. Those familiar with the titular term would know that it actually comes from an old Bugs Bunny cartoon. It is the catchphrase of a character named Hassan, which he utilizes whenever he sets about trying to cut a thief, i.e. Daffy Duck, to bits. I really love Amanda London's misuse of i.e. all the time. That's one of my favorite details of this.
Yeah.
As the name of the character implies, this particular episode entitled Alibaba Bunny is set in the Middle East. But of course, what's actually going down in real life is no laughing matter. The character Hassan is quite zealous when it comes to swinging his sword. And basically what The Offspring is saying is something like ISIS being the same way. So you kind of get that things are complicated, you know? And what better way to understand than through that?
Wow.
So
okay.
I guess like with all that in mind, you know, it's pretty heady. And I think
like that no one said anything worse than... worse than, like I thought I was going to be the one who's was a fool.
Yeah.
But no, it is truly Dexter. Yeah. So it looks like starting around 2012. Sorry, I was just like looking for when people realized that Alibaba Bunny was like maybe not like the best Looney Tunes to celebrate. And yeah, 2012. It looks like is when people started saying like, hey, I think this is kind of racist. Well. So.
Luckily, Dexter has
at least 10 years of mainstream conversation around that cartoon.
But Dexter's bringing it back due to beheadings, so that's kind of an interesting.
It's beheadings,
and I think
it's
you know,
giving beheadings.
it is very, you know, no pun. It's a very heady topic. But The Offspring, I think, have threaded the needle of you know, foreign policy and complex. You know, the thing about the caliphate, I think, was probably said in character, and I would assume that the Offspring fans are smart enough to know that. But I think what we really need to do is just watch an 8-year-old boy play drums to it and say the line is. So here's an 8-year-old boy playing the song. And you know what? He's pretty sick. I hope that someone teaches him about cool hardcore. Show this kid some Killed by Death comps. Let's get him out of this. I mean, this kid shreds.
I mean, it's nuts. It's truly nuts.
I don't even
nuts
know.
Nuts is an ableist, right? We can say, is nuts still cool?
Yeah, nuts because it makes you think of the salt and vin, right? Nuts.
Just yeah. Just cracking open that bag. It's so, like, it's really inexplicable. Like, really, really inexplicable.
I just can't even, like, imagine, again, his lyrics, his explanation of the song is, like, the most insane thing I've ever seen. Like, not even Amanda London could do worse than that.
Yeah, like Dexter kind of made Amanda London seem like pretty grounded.
Exactly.
Like, it's beheadings. It feels like an Amanda London phrase.
So what's your final thoughts on Hassan Chop? I think my final thought is like, it makes me really, you know, obviously I don't condone, I would say 99% of what happens in this song, but it makes me happy to know that there are still, like, people complain about cancel culture all the time, but you can just, like, release this song and say that that's what it's about, and, like, people will let you do that still. And that's, like,
yeah,
you
know, that's true.
That's freedom of speech right there, really.
It is, yeah. You know what? Thank you. Like, I feel like, does Elon Musk know about the Offspring? Because I feel like he would chill out if he did.
Yeah,
like, they're like, out here. It's fine.
They can
and cops are beating up their fans, and like,
and we're condoning it mostly. I think.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I still kind of am on the police side in that video. Still, despite everything. Okay.
Yeah, you don't know if like maybe the Abbey PD is investigating. They're like literally right before that guy yelled Hassan Chah.
You're like, okay. That's fair then. Yeah, you deserved it. Right. He had it coming to him. Okay, up next is my notes are disgusting vocals, kind of Evanescence vibes. That's right. It's the bizarre, like, anime betrayal sounding orchestral piano version of Gone Away that was tacked on here for some reason. What the fuck is this?
Yeah, I just wrote, it does feel like heaven is so far away. I mean, and I don't really want to spoil, I guess, and jump ahead to the next one, but like, it's almost like they doubted themselves. Like, they knew they wanted to end on like a somber note of that sort of recalled, I guess, the rest of the record, if not the band's career. And so just to like hedge and put this like really genuinely terrible version of like, you know, what I bet even the band kind of knows is like their actual best like song, you know, like
I forgot about this. All one. Other, I guess we'll have to do it.
It's
next.
Really good.
Offspring November.
Yeah. Offsember. Like it's a great song. I think it's aged really well. It sounds good. I mean, it's slow and it's like era specific or whatever, but it's like a really good 90s alt rock jam. And to included here as a way to like get people to pay attention again. It's like, I mean, it's fine, I guess, but it's so sad. If it wasn't, it's sad. It's really sad.
What? Like, it also just sounds fucking crazy. Let's be honest.
I just feel like so much on this record, like this idea of like, maybe the punkest thing to do as a punk band is not be punk, is like a horrible, stupid thing that these people say all the time. But like, in general, it is a way that I felt revisiting this, like with the way that they look and the way that they're writing songs, you're like, maybe they are the punkest band.
Maybe the punkest thing to do is be terrible and disgusting and a piece of shit who's stupid and sounds and looks awful at all times. I agree.
Exactly. And then, like, this doesn't feel... I can't square this with the punk mindset that I have applied to The Offspring.
I guess what I'm trying to figure out is... You're mentioning sequencing the album. Like... I know people put tons of tracks on albums because of streaming and they want to just make it. At this point, are they just putting things at the end that try to like jar you? Like, you're getting lulled and then you're getting woken up by something jarring like Hassan Chop and then you get soothed again. Is it just like basically breaking you down and building you up again with various torture means? Or
yeah, it's like boot camp. Yeah.
Because it does feel like they put like all the kind of songs that they believed in at the start and then like the songs that they thought they would believe in but were a mistake, they put in between these like bizarre gimmick string things.
Yeah, it like, I don't know, man. It's just so bad.
It's so good.
Like, and again, I just feel like, is it just an attempt to get a song on a streaming playlist but then just release it as a single? Like, but I guess you're right. It's to juice the numbers for the whole album.
Because I am looking at the normal...
Inexplicable.
The normal track listing does play in the same order as the deluxe. It's not like they changed it to, like, be pretentious or something. It's the same. So, I don't know. But here's Dexter doing this version of it live at the Woodlands in Houston, Texas.
Hardest thing that we can go through in life, I think, right?
And look at all those candles behind
me. I wrote the song. I wanted to try to express that feeling as true as I could.
I definitely think they should never talk is another thing that works against them. Every time they talk, I'm just like, who? So,
anyway, here it is.
And he looks insane.
I like that it's him playing the piano. Oh man, I'm back to loving it. Every time I think I'm out.
Also, this song, especially in the piano version, makes me realize how much it's all around me are familiar faces. Oh, yeah. Someone pointed out, I forget who, how much he seems like Neil Young sometimes. And, like, definitely if he had different hair, he could be Neil Young right now.
Yeah, he kind of sings like him. He's good. Yeah, like, I get it, he's aging, but it's like, one of the things that's so great with that song is the, like, there's probably also a way of playing the song where he doesn't, because if he tried to play it as a full-on rock song and went down the octave, it would be kind of a bummer. Whereas in this context, it's like part of the restrained emotion.
That's true. There's, like, strings on the recording, but I don't think... Whoa. I don't remember if there was drums on the...
I don't think so. I don't want to find out.
So this song is about, like, how it's bad to be dead or something? Is that right?
Yeah, yeah. It's an anti-death song.
Finally.
Taking a bold Someone's stance against dying.
Well, like, it was hard to find a cover that wasn't a cover of the original, but I think this one probably counts. I'm just sending you the username on here so we can try to figure out what it's... I think it's called... Celticize Me and Jazz Me Up by Marianne. Repeat that.
What?
So it's like the word Celtic with, I guess, exercise. Like, Celticize Me and Jazz Me Up by Marianne is the name of this Celtic cover of the song. This is Gone Away, covered on Celtic harp. And Celticize Me and Jazz Me Up by Marianne writes, early November is the time of the year when we honor the dead. The song is about coping with grief and remembering loved ones we lost. And there is a horny person replying immediately. Altuna, your piano, writes, this is both uplifting and sad at the same time. Perfect for thinking of those who were once in our lives but aren't anymore. That outfit you're wearing is super beautiful, BTW. So just got to get it in there real quick. I think they almost got away with it, maybe. But I mean, she's really Celticizing it here. She's in front of some sort of Celtic bog. With her Celtic harp.
The famous Celtic bog.
I mean, she's Celticizing me. I don't know. How are you feeling Celticized-wise?
I'm pretty Celticized.
Oh, someone walked by with a dog in their background, and then it cut the shot.
Imagine if you were just walking through your favorite bog. Oh, wow, there's a drone shot.
I would actually think that I was, like, hallucinating.
Is just a woman Celticizing your local bog? There's a bunch of people walking around.
There's so many people.
It's a public bog.
Cuts to B-roll of like an eagle or something. Is that a Celtic eagle?
Looks like a falcon.
I mean, oh yeah, that's true. Wow, you know your birds.
Well, I know the difference between an eagle and a falcon.
Is early November a time? Is early November a time when we honor the dead? Is that true?
If you're Celtic. I mean, it's true, though, isn't it? Like, there's, like, All Souls Day, right? That's real.
I thought that was Halloween.
Come on, man.
I don't know the days.
All Souls Day is November 2nd. Yeah, because there's All Saints Day
In all caps, Vivian wrote, marvelous, magnificent, the gift of Apollos. Seems like it's, like, Will Ferrell dialogue. The gift of Apollos. yeah,
this
so this
is so Celtic.
I'm feeling Celticized.
I find myself visiting this song quite often.
Wow. I would love to go to this bog. There is some
this
interesting
is a
camera
bog to me now.
The Celticized bog. I mean, this would have been a place to end the album, and it's definitely a weird thing to put second last on the album.
Well, it's a weird thing to put second last, so do we want to let the bog play
out? Yeah, let
we'll
the bog...
about the actual last song?
Yeah, well, I mean, final thoughts on this one, I hate it. I think it's disgusting.
It's
terrible.
Depressing. Everything about it is depressing. Yeah, I agree.
Except that we got to meet Celticize Me and... What is that? Celticize me and jazz me up
by Marianne. So that was good.
The person's found her. They're just looking over from the path. She's met someone. That would be so cool if there was if a murder took place in the background of this and then it became part of the investigation. That seems like it could be an 80s movie.
We're going to have to confiscate your bog videos.
We're going to have to confiscate your bog harp. Now,
calling to the witness stand, Celticize Me and Jazz Me Up by Marianne. Murder witness.
Oh my God. The last song is called Lullaby by The Offspring. I mean...
So this is so sad. Like, that's the thing. I just thought this was depressing because
I think they were trying to make an. I think they were like, let's make an honest to God album and let's have a thing bookend it. Like, it's some, you know, like just the word bookend comes to mind with this.
Sure, but the idea, like, my note here is like they couldn't decide if they wanted to end with a retro throwback or a nowtro throwback, so they just did both. And it just like it just feels so like creatively. indecisive.
Which, I feel like we haven't played most of the song. I think we should play this one so people can hear. In case you haven't listened, or if you need a refresher, because it's been a full 12
right
hour
by,
day
by now,
this.
It's good. Yeah, yeah.
Let's hear what.
Do you want to read Amanda over? Like, we don't need to listen to this, right? We can talk.
I just want them to know what happens here, because it's important to realize like there's these vibes, but then. Something comes in right now. He says, don't be thinking we're crazy, but then there's one more thing. Don't be thinking we're crazy. So then it goes to some insane, a new kind of fucked up vocal effect. And so I just wanted to play that as a refresher before you read what Dexter said first, which he says, Lullaby bookends the record and reminds you of the message of the record, let the bad times roll. The message of the record is just the title and the name of one of the songs and the lyrics of the lullaby. The topics are all subsidiary to the main overarching theme of these bad times.
Sorry, did Amanda London write this?
She goes,
we got some subsidiary topics over here?
I imagine Lullaby to be like listening to a phonograph record. It's that final spiral in the middle that repeats over and over again. It's a little theatrical. That's what Dexter said about it.
What if Amanda London, which we are assuming is a sort of nom de blog, is like the third, because we already know Dexter Holland is a lie. And so like, what if Amanda London is just part of the web of intricate,
one of his,
you know, personalities, one of his many personalities. And he's like, well, I want to control the narrative. I know, you know, song meanings isn't popping the way it used to. So I feel like these morsels for fans to find.
We're going to hear what Amanda London says, obviously, but I don't think she could sum it up as well as this reminds you of the message of the record. Let the bad times roll.
When, what a message. Message received, Dexter. Thank you.
Received. We did the bad times challenge. Amanda says, this is the last track on the standard playlist of Let the Bad Times Roll, i.e. the album it is featured on. And that phrase, Let the Bad Times Roll, plays a major role in this terse song. And according to the way Dexter Holland explained its purpose, it is intended to reiterate the theme of the project as illustrated by its title. The Offspring also uses the opportunity to assert that they are not crazy. Perhaps what they are speaking to is the fact that even in this day and age, it is quite uncommon for a mainstream music act to drop an entire album centered on and arguably embracing, based on its title, the theme of depression. But it seems like what the Offspring rather set out to do was put together an album which is the sign of the times, in the very least from their own perspective. But either way, now is not the time to reanalyze Let the Bad Times Roll. This is rather the undertaking's lullaby, which, as its name suggests, is intended to send us off peacefully into the night. But at the same time, it is also to remind the listening audience that verily the bad times are upon us.
Is she getting paid by Big Verily, do you think?
It's interesting that none of these are... Like, I had to search each song separately, but it kind of also feels like she did take, like, a school project and chop it up into a bunch of different blog posts.
Interesting. I'm leaving this episode with more questions than answers as to Amanda London's motives and identity.
Well, there is a sort of somewhat of a live video. They did play this maybe as people are walking in.
Or is this like the intro? Is this like before the encore or something? This feels like.
I feel like their set looks expensive though. Like.
Yeah, I think they're a very popular band, dude.
And then finally, there is a cover of this by Black Friday. And this guy's guitar face is just like a very sinister, it's like that movie Smile kind of grin.
Oh, he does look like the poster for Smile.
Yeah, it's. So what's your final thoughts on the song Lullaby by The Offspring from Let the Bad Times Roll?
Well, I mean, I think it does sum up the theme of the record, which is let the bad times roll. message received. To be honest, like, we took the bad times challenge, and like, this feels like
bad times abounded. This was admirably exhaustive, I think. I think we did that. We made good on Jimmy's.
I agree.
So finally, as a nice little bonus, you know, I did post this earlier today, but I think it deserves to be played on the pod as well. This is pre-Bad Times. This is the Offspring
that
Argentina.
We've never really done before.
And I thought that as a way of saying goodbye to The Offspring, this is a good video to play. This is The Offspring. Excuse me, I'm dying over here. I've had so many bevies to get through this. This is The Offspring covering a nice little tune by One Direction.
Written in these walls are the stories that I can't explain.
Now, I don't think I know that. Like, do you know this song?
Oh, yeah, it's a huge hit. You probably know the chorus.
Only the girls know this song.
Well, there you go, Noodles.
I read the One Direction book, and it's great.
I saw the doc. One Direction was so good. They should come back.
Now that I've read that everything I need to get through, I'm ready to embrace One Direction.
I don't even understand why they would cover this song in like 2016. It's so bizarre.
It's a good song.
So, I mean, I think, you know, talking about The Offspring for 2 months paid off in ways that both expected and unexpected. I want to thank Sam. I want to thank Amanda London. I want to thank Dexter and Kevin Noodles.
Come on. No, I guess it's okay. You know what? At the end, I'm okay with knowing that. But thank you for saving me. Until this moment. What a ride. I want to thank Brian, Kevin. There's like a Kyle in the band. I want to thank Pete Parada.
One of the guys
that I know is the anti-vax drummer.
One of the new guys that I... Last week I photoshopped our friend Don Hughes. When he guested, I photoshopped him over one of the guys in suits on their current press photo, and he's like such a fuckboy looking guy. And Don told me that his dad saw the picture and said, where did they get a photo of you in a suit? So I must have done a really good job photoshopping it.
But. Great Photoshop. Yeah, thanks to Josh Freeze. Thanks to the guy from Anti-Flag, who I kind of think is in the band.
I also love how they can't even play together. There's three guys who are just completely out of sync. Beautiful day.
They're just vibing. Which is why I thank you to you for
thank you, Sam.
This video.
And you still get another, and now you still get another half hour with our guests. So stay tuned, folks. Good evening. Goodbye. Well, somehow we're still talking about The Offspring, Sam, and we've.
I thought the month was over.
We've roped in two more people to talk about The Offspring with us. Welcome to the show, Nick Ciarelli and Brad Evans. What's going on?
Hello.
What's up? Hey.
I guess like to start, do either of you have any? Like, something that we're still struggling with and what keeps bringing me back is, like, I don't understand who likes The Offspring, but a lot of people clearly do. Like, is one of you maybe a big Offspring fan?
No, I've been aware of them, you know, like, in the 2000s and 90s and stuff, but I was never big into them.
I was a big fan of them growing up. I had, I loved Americana. Is that's the album, right, with the...
Why Don't You Get a Job?
Yeah, why don't you get a job?
Pretty Fly. Yeah, a lot of hits.
I liked the Hit That song. I liked that a lot.
So you were a fan. Okay.
I was a fan. Taxi, too. All the Crazy Taxi songs.
Taxi has been a big part of this month.
Yeah. You know, knowing that we've got Jimmy Fallon writers here, I think I'm going to bring back the bit that bombed earlier in the month and just ask you, in today's woke culture, what do you think Crazy Taxi would be called nowadays in the modern times?
It would be called Chemically Imbalanced Rideshare Vehicle.
There you go.
I would say like millennials too hooked on the crazy apps that they can't focus on driving well.
Oh, true. That's true. Different vibe with it.
What you can't say anything anymore. The name of Crazy Taxi would literally be 14 words long.
It's like a Babylon Bee headline.
Yeah. You would have to flip the case over to finish reading the name.
You liked The Offspring. What else? Did either of you have like a punk phase, or do you now identify as punk? Are you like taking down NBC from the inside punk style?
No, definitely not doing that. I don't think I ever identified as punk. I went to some kind of emo punk type shows as a teen that were like other teenagers.
Punk type show mean here? Is this like how are skewing emo based on the way that you sort of leaned into it? Like describe these shows.
Yeah.
You'd see two or three bands. Some of them would be kind of ska punk. Some of them would be kind of emo or screamo. It was a big like mix of things, just like late 2000s, you know, usually in a garage of a house. Yeah, that your parents are out of town or in a parking lot.
Perfect. So you get, you know, what's up. That's already makes you cooler than an Offspring fan, in my opinion.
It was down in Orange County where the main Offspring guy is from. Are they all from there? I don't even know.
We don't really know anything about them either. We don't even know their real names, actually. It's been 2 months and almost 24 hours of talking about them. We've learned nothing at this point.
Josiah, I think, might know Noodle's name, but he's been kind of not telling me.
I know what it is. I just remembered. They have weird names.
Don't tell me.
Dexter Holland, his real name is Brian. Is that like...
Is that when he changed to Dexter?
Yeah. Like going from Brian to Dexter is kind of...
Yeah, he wanted a punk name.
Dexter's Lab was a hit show.
Yeah, that's it. Just,
oh, yeah, yeah. When he was like 25 years old, he watches Dexter's Lab and he's like, I'm going to change my name.
This is it.
Yeah, this is my identity.
So, but Nick, you didn't stick with them after Americana. You kind of like, did you get Sufjan Stevens after or something?
Yeah, I was pretty big into Sufjan. That was kind of my trend, my evolution as a person. I was like 10 years old and I was listening to these guys saying about being a white guy who can rap or whatever, and then I went straight to Sufjan singing about John Wayne Gacy.
Right.
That was a weird year for you.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a weird year. Both, I guess they're both kind of Americana, really, at the end of the day.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Damn.
Okay, so you're at least, you know, aware of The Offspring, I think, a healthy amount. If you were like, oh, I'm a mega fan and I love the new Offspring, we might actually have hung up on you because I'm scared of those people. But I think it's worth still really doing an in-depth look at just two music videos from the album Let the Bad Times Roll, of which Sam and I have spent the entire night breaking down in great length. So,
when did this album come out? Is it this year? Or?
Last year. This is from 2021. I mean, what else can we say? What else needs
Someone has definitely said this album got them through the worst of the pandemic. You know that there are people who who have written that probably, and so we like to think of them when we discuss this album.
That's true.
Yeah.
So this is the title track. I know I sent it to you earlier, but I think we should really give the video some credit. So feel free to pause as you see fit, or we can talk over. But this is the Let the Bad Times Roll video.
And there's a volume slider in your own watch together window.
Yeah, I'm going to turn it up.
I'm going to crank it louder.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Like, I already love how the video's shot, like, maybe if you put some lip balm on it or something and accidentally touch the camera on your phone and then it's, like, ruined. It has this sort of, like...
Yeah. It's got a real Vaseline clean to it.
Yeah.
Yeah, you set your phone down in, like, a gross, like, bar bathroom. Face down, and you pick it up, and you can't see anything on the screen.
And then you're seeing the Offspring guys.
Yeah, and your phone decided to play this song.
But I think this video is like has a maybe a black mirror. But like, so this is kind of what you were saying earlier, the crazy phone.
Right.
Yeah, this is definitely millennials and their crazy apps. Like, you basically like riffed right into this
you
video.
Called it. And I think the flame effect was done with a crazy app, like a special effects app.
For sure. You don't think that was real fire?
Oh, oh my god.
Oh, shit. Oh wow.
So I guess if you're only listening, the girl just... Okay, we need to. Okay, yeah, we need to slow down here. There's a lot going on.
Yeah,
so she took a pill. There's a. It goes to the next character. She took a pill. It made her hand get big, and now the fake mid-century modern Wayfair chair is talking to her in her room.
But she also has like 25 rolls of toilet paper in her.
Yeah, so that room. Makes me think Sam riffed that part into existence, talking about the. Does it show what the pill bottle is? Like what
I think it's just like pill brand things? Pills. Yeah, I would like these pills.
I bet it's just this ADHD medication they give to these millennials these days.
Yeah.
Yeah. They used to say play with a fucking stick. Now they're just cranking them full of drugs.
Micro Z. Is that a thing? Is that a drug? Micro Z.
Micro Z?
It's a diuretic medication often used to treat high blood pressure and swelling. So I think that they just didn't cover someone's real prescription. That was
yeah. It's probably like Noodles' prescription or whatever.
Yeah, for sure. Like, oh, who's got a pill bottle with them on set? And it's like absolutely one of the members of the
band. Rock blood band that doesn't medication. Even have like illicit drugs. They just have blood pressure medication.
And blood pressure medication and diuretics.
Okay, so she kind of looked at the pill bottle in a sinister way too, like she was like,
"Yeah,
not hers." She's
experimenting. Right. Yeah. Well, it's like these millennials want to, abuse all their parents' medication to get a thrill.
She looked at that pill bottle like, "Oh yeah, my hands are about to get big."
Now and they did. I mean, I would take that pill if
the big hand
assuming
pill.
Assuming it's temporary, you temporarily have enormous like foam finger hands. Imagine if you're going to a sporting event, you could save so much money.
Save so much money, depending on the price of the drug. Oh, yeah.
Imagine if you're trying to hail a cab, or to put it in these millennial terms, like right. Uber.
Yeah,
exactly. So it does that, and then it makes. I mean, if my chair started singing this song, I would be upset.
Yeah. But and what about all the paper. Toilet paper stockpiling? This video was made during the pandemic, I guess, right?
Everything had toilet paper in it for the...
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you guys have to write jokes about the toilet paper
stuff? No, we didn't write... We never touched the toilet paper material.
Well, no one really wrote those jokes, I guess. They just said...
No.
There was no writing involved.
Yeah. We were in New Orleans, and I was at some place where they had people were like, it was like an art fair thing, and somebody did little arts of cartoons, and it was a picture of Mr. Burns, and he had a bunch of toilet paper behind him, and it said TP hoarder.
That's so good.
I'm like, that must be from COVID.
Yeah, someone was spending a lot of, their quarantine.
Quarantine was tough on everybody.
But if you if you were hoarding toilet paper, it wouldn't be in the living room of your... basement suite like this girl has here, right?
Like, yeah. I feel like you're seeing natural light here. I don't know if this is a basement suite.
Okay, that's true. Maybe ground level.
It's a pretty fancy apartment.
Yeah.
It's a fireplace. I think it's like, or like a fake wall that you press a brick and it turns
whoa.
Okay.
I mean, it's too many narratives at once. Now the cockroach is here and it's giant. And is it wearing a COVID mask also?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This cockroach loves Fauci.
What side? This is like, what side is the Offspring on here where they're like, oh, are you a bug? A lowly bug wearing your mask?
Yeah.
It's kind of,
I think it's the pills made her. I think the cockroach is actually 8 feet tall, but then the pills made her hallucinate it's wearing a COVID mask.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's like, that's like the bad vibes of the.
Right. Does she still have giant hands, though? She could swat it.
Yeah.
I don't know how to finish these.
Yeah, it was right there for them.
So you like the song Get a Job. He does say bitch again in this song. It's just worth
pointing out. Oh, great. That's good.
He loves to say bitch. But this time he's talking about Hillary. You'll love that part. Yeah, as a Get a Job head, you'll love the use of the word bitch. Oh, now the game is shooting at him.
Damn.
Oh, it's a cat game?
Oh, nice. That's funny.
It's like a 2006 cat
video.
Yeah. Really, really early YouTube.
You spend a little too much online and you start to think it's real.
Yeah.
Is that what this is?
These are the type of guys that like probably saw like the Laser Cat SNL sketch and like thought it like came out like this year or something.
Oh yeah,
we got to do something on this.
No, they're gonna like sue them like next year when they see it. We did that as a video.
You stole our idea from us.
Yeah.
I mean, to Sam's point about the COVID aspect, all of these little segments so far feel like they're some kind of commentary, but I don't know about what or for whom. Like, what are they trying to say? Something that the video game became real to him?
I think they're trying to say that, like, you kids these days are playing video games too much.
And the video game, because that, you know, back in our day, we had games like Pong, or even before video games, we had Hoop and Stick. And you knew that was a game, but now these video games are so realistic.
No,
when a cat is shooting lasers out of its mouth at you, you're like...
With reality.
Yeah.
Well, you had your business Hoop and Stick and your pleasure Hoop and Stick. It was a
great
combination. So,
That's a little heteronormative of you, but that's fine.
Okay, here's a new character.
Oh, what?
So it's like The Purge?
Purge.
It was like Slipknot?
Or it's like a Rob Zombie.
Slipknot has broken into this guy.
These are some of Fauci's masked goons.
I mean, do you guys know that, like, this era of The Offspring, maybe it was just before they did this song, they did have to fire their drummer for being such a staunch anti-vaxxer.
Okay.
The drummer was, like, on Joe Rogan and stuff. Like, I think that they are pro Fauci, or at least I don't know.
This song is about being with her.
Like, yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Well, okay.
Like,
so
when
never
he
mind.
Says "bitch," he's calling Hillary Clinton a bitch, but in sort of an ironic pretending.
Oh, okay.
So.
Oh right. Well, it's
I'm
weird
sure
that like the
get that nuance. I'm sure they understand.
Yeah.
That.
It's interesting that like the lead singer to like the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones is also like an anti-vax guy.
Yeah.
Like it
yeah.
feels like there are it is like a pool of like this type of like 90s punk ska scene. Like
yeah,
there's always like one guy who's like very anti-vax.
Or is it all people who work for late night shows? Hey,
yeah,
what about
yeah.
you two? Huh?
I haven't made up my mind yet on the vax. I'm kind of like I'm gonna wait one or
just
two more years.
More information. Then. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm doing my own research.
Yes. What?
Now there is COVID. I think. Wait, okay. That literally is COVID, right?
Yeah,
those are the famous droplets.
Wait.
The famous gray droplets that are COVID.
So they're already living in some sort of techno dystopia where the video games and toilet paper are coming to life. Why was she hoarding toilet paper before the droplets were there? Also, is she getting reinfected? Or...
I think they were all in isolation, and then whatever the shit happened made the droplets spray everywhere. Those punks came in and they're spraying
they're anti-mask
insurrectionists. That was the insurrection,
right? But it's weird that the anti-maskers were all masked in this instance.
right.
In this metaphorical usage.
Yeah.
It really is just COVID.
That is what COVID looks like.
This seems like a good way to, like, if you can't think of an ending, just make everyone get COVID and be like, so fucked up.
Yeah.
They look like they're from, like a detergent ad where it's like, you hate, you know, you can't get these nasty dirt particles out of your clothes. And they're like,
meh. Yeah.
It's kind of shocking.
Yeah, they saw me.
Yeah, it's like some comedian that got Me Too'd with like the voice of the dirt particles.
Yeah.
Like it was like Chris D'Elia. Now they're like, oh, yeah.
And then it shows the wacky Apple filters. Wow.
Okay, oh. And they're all on Zoom.
They're on Zoom now.
Wow.
They seem fine. I guess they...
Because they connected.
Zoom saved them.
It's just a cord,
right.
Really. So that's why.
Right. Yeah. It's not so bad.
So I guess, I mean, how did you feel about that video? What, any thoughts? Obviously I have none, but if there's any critiques of it, there's room for that as well. We want to be fair. But anything you have to say about that video?
I feel like it feels very timely for a year and a half before it came out. And which was already a year ago now.
Yeah.
It's very like I feel like so many people made art in 2020, but then it like takes a while to shoot a video and record the tracks, and then it's like by the time it comes out, people are like, look, I have my commentary on this era, then it's like, oh no, everyone's sick of this. We hate stuff about this.
But again, like the lyrics are about kind of like things that Trump said in the lead up to the 2020 election. So it's also, that's interesting. It's like every bad idea at once. It's like, it should have probably come out in like 2015, maybe.
Right. Well, that would have been a warning about COVID.
Yeah, that would have been very precedent. It would have been like the most precedent song of all time.
Yeah, it would have been like The Simpsons. They're always predicting things.
Right. People are loving it though. In the YouTube comments, we've got Nancy D. This dystopian nightmare of a world we now inhabit seems a little less hellish now that I've discovered this song/video, and know Dexter and the rest of the guys are also living it. I love this. You captured it well. Thank you. So that's not quite this saved my life, you got me through COVID, but like we're getting close. I'm looking for it.
Yeah.
Well, maybe this is kind of the appetizer, you know, it's a little more highbrow, a little bit Charlie Brooker vibes, obviously, with the technology.
Right. Yeah.
But the Offspring can have some fun with it. Obviously, they're known for their humor. They're a little wacky with it.
Yeah, so they're a funny band.
Let's check out the song and video, We Never Have Sex Anymore. This is probably one of the most insane videos I've ever seen in my life. And I have to.
Is this a song the Offspring wrote about themselves? They're like, we all never have sex with each other
anymore. As a band?
Yeah.
Or is it like one of them wrote it to a woman or whoever?
I mean, we have done some in depth lyrical analysis that made me feel almost seasick from the song meaning website we were trying to read was very poorly written and confusing.
That's not true, man. You take that back about Amanda London.
Amanda London is a great music journalist, which I was going to say, when both of these came out, I was a music journalist at the time. And like, you know, if a record label wanted us to publish this, like I had to write blog posts about both of these videos from a semi-sincere standpoint. So I've already had a strange experience with these.
Yeah. Oh wow, yeah.
Especially when you get to do this one. We Never Have Sex Anymore video. Now, one thing about this that you need to know, that I don't know how deep we can get, but PETA was very upset about this video. And so,
oh,
you know,
right.
The one before this, there's the anti-vax element with the drummer, and then this one, PETA was so upset. I don't know why. I mean, these monkeys are having a great time. This is We Never Have Sex Anymore video. Maybe they're mad about
this time you saw like a movie or a TV show this prominently featuring monkey actors. Like, it does feel like this is...
That's what PETA ruins the fun, right?
Out of time, yeah.
Yeah, this feels like a car insurance commercial from like 2001.
Yeah.
But like, does PETA care about the... Because, like, these are animals that have jobs. Like, they're actors. And so by PETA constantly protesting it, like, that's just not fair to these hardworking monkey actors.
Yeah, right. They're getting to watch strippers. They're not even watching them.
I don't know why they're... So far, and that's something I don't love is when music videos have narratives, because it's like, they never make sense. But so far, there's just the singer of The Offspring wanted to be near strippers. Perhaps because he's not getting any sex, but then it's just a domestic monkey situation so far.
Right. I'm like, stick to your thing. Even the other one, I'm like, we don't need to keep cutting to the band singing.
Yeah.
Do more of these whimsical COVID Black Mirror images.
Yeah. Show me those hands.
I guess there was a monkey thing in Nope, right? That was the kind of...
Oh, yeah.
Maybe that was inspired by The Offspring's We Never Have Sex
Anymore. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Jordan Peele's probably watching this and was like, oh, yeah, I got a great idea for a movie.
Big springhead, I think. Yeah.
That's embarrassing that they put this monkey in this in his underpants.
Yeah.
That's what PETA was mad about.
The one monkey was reading a book called Love's Dare. Musically, how do you feel about this song? Do you like this song? This kind of...
It's kind of big band, you know?
Yeah.
A little more stuff. I don't know. Lyrically, I think it's very weird. It's very, like, incel lyrics, but from an old famous man.
That's true. But also, old cells. There's no jokes in the lyrics. Like, it's very sincere. That's what makes it so confusing.
Right, yeah, yeah, because they are, like, a band that, like, yeah, like, will insert, like, yeah, humor jokes into, like, there's stuff or, like, lines that are couldn't be conceived as jokes. But, yeah, this just feels pretty.
This is just like, literally, like,
how could be feels. Conceived as jokes. It's, like, a really.
Yeah. That's,
it's like when you're, like, let's be careful. We got to say allegedly before we describe, you know.
Like, yeah, yeah, yeah.
This, yeah. The lyrics of this are, like, spousal abuse. Like, you owe me sex. So then maybe that's why they had to put monkeys in it. Lessen the blow.
I'm still very interested in the idea of interpreting it as the band complaining that they don't like that it used to just be a, like a non-stop
fucking
escapades. Fucking
yeah, yeah. No one wants a fucking Offspring anymore.
That's why they call them noodles.
Yeah, yeah. This is about Dexter and noodles.
Also, why aren't the monkeys strippers? Why is it human strippers?
Yeah,
wow. Something for the fellas to watch.
Now it I thought. The, go ahead.
Just the setting of it being in a strip club for the lip syncing portion is very strange.
Yeah. Do you think after this music video, after Dexter played this for his wife, do you think she had sex with him again?
I think it works.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Because this is like, this is sort of like written to her. This is like a song from a man to his wife saying, why don't you fuck me anymore? And here's chimpanzees acting out our lives.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm hanging out with strippers.
I know how much you hate chimps. And so I.
Yeah. Yeah. He was like, I get the. No, go ahead.
Is this a monkey's hand or a human hand? Like that.
I think it's a human hand.
That is disgusting looking.
I think that's a monkey's hand.
I think it is too. I think I can slow it down in here.
Do you think the monkey's really crying?
I think that, yeah.
That's why PETA's mad. They made this monkey cry real tears.
Yeah, yeah.
They like showed him pictures of his dead parents.
They like locked up his kid.
I think that's a monkey. I think that was a monkey.
That's disgusting.
That's a monkey.
Yeah, I think that's monkey hands.
It was either a monkey or like a burnt child, I think.
Yeah. PETA wasn't protesting that.
Well, what are they mad about at this point? I mean, I thought they just got mad if monkeys like smoked or drank alcohol. But these monkeys are just kind of like, are they angry that the monkeys are participating?
They don't want like monkeys to go through a marriage story. They don't like want them to experience like, that kind of
just in case
domestic sadness.
Just in case they punch a drywall.
They have a soft hand.
They were mad that the monkeys weren't the strippers, too. They just thought it was, like, unequal treatment.
Yeah, yeah.
They're always desexualizing the monkeys.
Yeah, they're always going to be sexy, too.
Oh, wait, do you think they let this monkey drive a car?
Oh, okay.
Because they're mad?
Monkeys definitely call strippers peelers. The Alberta term.
Cheetahs, that's in L.A. That's a real strip club.
Oh, right on.
Oh, the monkey's
okay,
here.
Okay, so why?
So, yeah, this is, I mean.
This is, like, the most confusing part of the music video to me.
Yeah.
I have so many questions about it, and I guess my first question is more of an observation, but is John Stamos really rich, or is he really desperate for money? Because the other thing about this, knowing about this, I saw this video probably 6 months after I visited Graceland in Memphis for the on a road trip, and to travel through Graceland, you get an iPad, and it's narrated by John Stamos, and you point it at different items, and he tells you the background, and it's like, what is he doing?
Like, that's
what
cool.
What does he do with his day?
I don't know if these are just Canadian ads, but he's in these, like, very, very cheap, like, gambling ads, like, online casino, like, slots, like, not even, like, the sports gambling stuff that Aaron Paul does that's, like, corny, but reasonable. Like, it's like looks like it's shot on an iPhone, him being like, I could kick back at home and just play slots. And it's like the really tragic ads. Like, do you guys see those, or is that like just an Ontario thing?
Yeah, we don't get those down
here.
Yeah,
I haven't seen them.
So he's doing them, I guess, in like assuming that no one real will see them because they're just in Canada, but they're like profoundly shitty and embarrassing. Like, it's like he's gotta be hard up, like, something's going on there tax wise. Yeah.
Right.
Let me see if he's on Cameo, because that's how you can tell.
That's how you know who owes some taxes.
If he's affordable on Cameo, that's really sad.
Yeah. He's like $20-25. Yeah. You know, things are bad.
But that
he is
also
not. He is not on Cameo.
It confuses me again about the Offspring's level of fame, because I still feel like no matter how hard up he is, he seems too big for this Monkey Strip Club Offspring video.
I bet there's a history. You know, they both peaked in relevance in the same decade. they were probably both regular. Dexter and Stamos were probably regulars at Cheetah's with this chimp. they all got to reunite and collab and make some art together. It's sweet.
They actually wrote the video around the chimp's real story.
Is the guy across from the chimp Tom Green, like beside the long hair?
It looks like it. He was just there.
He almost looks like one of the other like background guys from early Tom Green, like Phil or whatever. Like, one of those guys. Tom Green left him behind when he moved back to Canada. Didn't remember.
So in this world, like, it's not like we're in monkey world. We're actually in human world, where there seemingly is only one male monkey and one female monkey.
True.
Like, there's no other monkeys in this. Like, it's not like Toontown or something.
But that's why it's so important for them to have sex. It's like pandas, too. Right, you know? Like, they need to.
Oh, that's right, gotta add, that's, and that's pressure. I mean, that's tough. You're not relaxed ever.
Have a ball.
This, can you look cool with sunglasses like that?
I don't think so.
No.
It's so weird how Dexter Holland looks so old, but he also looks like a 9-year-old dressing up like his dad at all times. Like, everything seems ill-fitting in a way.
Just wearing dad's sunglasses and suit.
Yeah, his dad was like a rockabilly guy and he just dresses up like him.
Yeah.
This song's kind of about life returning to normal post-COVID. You can go to a strip club and then share a drink with a chimpanzee.
Right.
Yeah.
That's what I missed the most during lockdown.
Oh, he's drunk driving. Boy.
Well, no, because I feel like quite visibly, I guess you could put booze in a Coke, but to me it looked like they were showing Stamos and the chimp enjoying simply a Coca-Cola.
Maybe PETA was angry on behalf of the chimp wife.
Right.
Oh, wow. He got some revenge on her. Because now she wants to have sex, but he doesn't.
That's true.
She's gone to a male strip club.
That is sort of shades of because why don't you get a job? Is sort of the same thing where there's sort of three verses about like a woman, you know, uses much harsher language, freeloading, and then at the very end he's like, also there's a guy, he's bad too. And I feel like there's this perfect sort of both sides vibe to the Offspring that is like leans pretty heavily towards one side.
I almost feel like they're like sort of barely concealed libertarian vibes are coming through here, where it's like, maybe what we should all do is live like the chimps live. And what can we learn from the chimps?
Live like the chimps live.
I don't know. I mean, what did you guys think of that one? Did you have any takeaways for us from that video?
I just think it's rather ridiculous to, you know, think of a man's wife not fucking him. Sure, that's a thing a lot of men experience. But then when you're like, oh, we are all just chimpanzees and we're supposed to fuck all the time.
That's true.
It's kind of absurd.
Yeah.
Are chimps known for fucking? Is that a thing?
Rabbits are, but I think just in order to animals, you know, prolong their species, they have to mate.
That's true. Wow.
Just the idea of two chimps not going to fucking town on each other is absurd.
I thought they flung their shit at each other was the main thing.
That's foreplay.
Wow.
Jesus.
All right. Oh, there you go.
I'm going to say wavelength.
Well, thank you so much for helping us make our final Offspring episode even longer. Before you go, like, where can people check you out, or what do you want to plug? I mean, this is probably one of the lows of your career, doing this with us. So appreciate it.
No. This was fun. I hope we helped Dexter Holland's wife learn her lesson.
Yeah. I hope this is going to all like the 55-year-old Offspring fans that will discover this episode can know that, you know, we love the band and, you know, there's a community for them.
Yeah. And if you relate to the Offspring songs about their wives not fucking them anymore, like, just like,
show your wife this video of these two chimpanzees not fucking each other. Crank the volume up, make her watch the whole thing, and then I think your relationship is going to be better.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, if you want to check out, me and Nick made a bunch of videos that are on Twitter and Instagram. You can follow us there and look it up. My Twitter is at Bradford Evans, and my Instagram is at Brad Evans Picture Boy.
And I'm Nick Ciarelli, my name on both.
Perfect. All right.
Awesome.
Would you guys, so you do work in TV now. Would you ever work with the champ, or would you, are you afraid of PETA's ire?
I'm afraid of PETA trying to cancel us. Yeah. All these millennial libs at PETA with their cell phones and their toilet paper, their mountains of toilet paper back home. No, I haven't worked with a chimpanzee yet. I think I'd be afraid to.
You've never really heard of a lib chimp, so that's true.
Yeah.
That's true. Lib chimp. But if you put enough of them at typewriters, one of them will write something. One will write vote blue, no matter who or whatever. Yeah. Animal actors, they're pathetic. BoJack Horseman taught us a valuable lesson.